With only two races remaining in the countdown to the championship, the NHRA Tour rolls into Las Vegas, Nevada. And there's no better time for drivers to go all in on a chance to become an NHRA champion. Top Fuel's Tony Schumacher won just twice in 18 regular season events, but in the countdown, no one has been better. He's won three of four playoff races, and going rounds today could be enough to cement a Top Fuel record 8th championship. Meanwhile, the Funny Car title race has been blown wide open. Shocking first round losses by John Force and Courtney Force in Redding opened the door for Matt Hagen to take over the points lead, and that's just what he did. The Redding winner has his eyes on a second NHRA crown, but he'll have to fight off a 16-time champion who will face the final two races this season without one of the best tuners in the business. It is time to shuffle up and deal in Las Vegas. Just like poker, NHRA drag racing, it's a game of skill and chance, and there is going to be a massive crowd on the rail today. And along with Mike Dunn, Gary Gerald, John Kernan, Bruno Massel, our entire ESPN2 crew, I am Dave Reif, and we are all in today at the Toyota Nationals, where the chip leader in Funny Car is the Virginia cattle farmer, Matt Hagen. He enjoys a 41-point lead over the 16-time champion, 81 better than Courtney Force entering today's racing action. Well, you know, Sin City isn't known just for Texas No Limit Hold'em. How about boxing? This Funny Car countdown battle is certainly worthy of title fight billing. And I want to take you back to the beginning of the 2014 season when Matt Hagen said, John Force has given two of my championship speeches. That will not happen again. He and Dickie Venables are certainly living up to their word. They're the number one qualifier here, the only sub 4 second car, and they have added a round of cushion in this championship battle. Matt Hagen, not only talking the talk, he is walking the walk. Meanwhile, there's a little bit of chaos going over in the pits of John Force, and that's where we find Mike Dunn.
Well, I can assure you, Dave, in the 16 championships that John Force has won, there's always a bit of controlled chaos. You pull in the factor that Jimmy Prock has left the team, and then with two races to go, that's got to add something to it. But John is confident with this team. He has a lot of talent here. John Mill and Danny Hood looking over the numbers here, still running the combination that Jimmy Prock was running. They are confident. They ran very well in qualifying. Number two qualifier. They were low ET of Friday night, but they still lost a round of racing to Matt Hagen in qualifying. It makes you kind of think, what's a guy got to do? But for John Force, we know he loves a fight, and he will fight to the end. This is going to be a great battle.
Well, the only fight in terms of championships that can be won in Las Vegas is in Top Fuel, where that man, Tony Schumacher, is in firm control. Cars are lit. We're at the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway to kick it off today. We have a Top Fuel champion, Larry Dixon, coming up against Khaled Belushi, the man who led the points after the first race of 2014. The rest of the matchups, they can be found on the Lucas Oil Ladder, where J.R. Todd is the number one qualifier for the third time during this countdown season. Tony Schumacher, Billy Torrance, that's the marquee matchup. Billy trying to keep the dream alive for Steve, Sean, and Doug.
Other side of the ladder, I'm looking at number two in the points, Doug Collette, to keep his hopes alive. He's going to have to beat Brittany Force. Brittany Force got her first round win last spring here in Vegas, but since then it's been 5-2 in Doug's favor.
It is a beautiful day as we kick things off, as we mentioned, with Larry Dixon, who has already had a weekend wow moment, and it came less than 24 hours ago in final qualifying. Big time kaboom.
The team was going for it, just got way too much wheel speed early up in smoke and over revved that engine and backfired the supercharger.
In just over a week since Larry Dixon turned 48, he will be taking on Khaled Belushi, who clinched a Pro Mod championship here back in 2011.
Track temp right now, 94 degrees. Track similar to Q3 conditions, high 70s, a definite possibility. Both lanes are pretty much equal.
Larry Dixon, of course, part of a two-car Bob Vandergrift team, as Dave Conley comes over and joins him next year. Oh, another big-time boomer for Larry. Give the win to Khaled, 377. But look at all the smoke just pouring out of the back of that Cased Hold Solutions dragster.
Jake, we get it with tire size and pressure.
Well, if you take another look at it, I'm sure the car was pretty much laboring right to that point before it let go. And, boy, it put a lot of stuff out when that thing knocked the supercharger off of that. And look at Larry's head just go straight down. If you take another look at it, Khaled Belushi did a very nice job with a good reaction time off of the starting line up to that point where Larry Dixon blew up. He was running halfway decent, but then I'm pretty sure it started laying over before, just an instant before that thing let go. And then you're going to see the huge explosion just about half track. And then Calabalusi, though, he's hurting some parts on the top end, but still makes a very nice pass.
Calab now 3-0 racing, the three-time Top Fuel champion lifetime. Of course, Dixon going to be part of the full-time tour in 2015. Next pairs, NHRA Safety Safari works to get Dixon's car off, will be Leah Pritchett and Antron Brown. That also means we are just six pair away from a living legend looking to add to his racing resume. John Kernan has more.
Tony Schumacher has been waiting for this day for five long years. That's how long it's been since he won his last Top Fuel championship. If he finds victory today, then he will clinch his eighth career title. It's a journey that began more than 2 years ago when they decided to switch to the six-disc clutch. Tony says they basically threw away 2 years, but despite inconsistent results, they stuck with it. And now that hard work is about to pay off. But first, Tony faces Billy Torrence in our marquee matchup. And because Billy's son Steve is still in contention for the title, he'd like nothing more than to spoil the Sarge's march to the championship. Joining us in the pits this week, two-time Comp Eliminator World Champ, Bruno Massel.
Well, with all the talk this week from John Force Racing being about sponsors and crew chiefs, Courtney Force has found herself pretty much flying under the radar here in Las Vegas, but the fact remains she is very much a contender for the Funny Car Championship. With wins in Dallas and in St. Louis, she just might be the first ever female Funny Car Champion. Now, as we head into eliminations, Courtney and the field are pretty much in an ironic situation because the top three cars in both the points and the qualifying ladder are in those exact same positions. Courtney sits third only behind her father John and points leader Matt Hagan.
We talk about one fast woman, Courtney Force, back in 2014 made the fastest pass ever to 1,000 feet. In fact, Mike Dunn, all of the fastest funny car speeds in history, every increment, have happened here at the strip.
Matt Hagan did it last night, 276 miles per hour back in 2007 when we were running a quarter mile. Mike Askey did it 334 miles per hour. And why are we talking about this when we're running Top Fuel? That's because Mike Askey's crew chief right there, Brian Corradi, Mark Oswald, just walked behind the car for his crew chief when he ran that speed.
Six wins this season for Antron Brown, the most of any driver in all four Mellow Yellow classes, yet finds himself back in the points in sixth. Leah Pritchett took that Dote Racing car to uncharted territory, lowering a career best by more than 0.02 of a second. She's going to give Antron a firm challenge here. She's going to take out Antron Brown. 379 beats a 380.
Good job, girl. Good job.
And Leah Pritchett gets her third round win in the 16th race of her season.
And she does it in great fashion. She had the whole shot advantage off of the starting line. I almost thought Dave this was looking back at Epi this year, where she had a great car in qualifying and then got beat by Calabalusi in the first round because he got it all together. Antron Brown really struggled in qualifying, and I thought possibly we could see the same thing happen. But Leah, with that great reaction time and that run on the racetrack, you look at the Lucas Oil photo finish cam, she gets the nod by about a quarter of a car length.
Well, again, the big story, despite the championship chase, are the changes that went on in John Force Racing. And basically, the nuts and bolts break down like this. Facing an uncertain future, Jimmy Prock, in the three-week break, tendered a resignation for the end of the year. It was accepted, however, immediately by the 16-time champion, who is in the staging lanes right now with John Kernan.
Now, Jimmy Prock, who had tuned you so far up to here, is now gone. He's over at DSR now. How did that all happen? And, you know, is it something you can overcome?
I can overcome anything. No man's an island. I don't build a race team that way. Or I would have failed a long time ago when Austin Coyle walked out. Bottom line, we want to wish Jimmy luck. Jimmy did a great job for us. I'm not just saying that. And he may be gone from John Force Racing, but he's not gone from our hearts. He won me a championship. He helped build our programs. That's just the way I look at life. And if I had time that I want to think about the other, all it can do is get me behind what I need to do, and that's to push these three funny cars toward win circle. My daughter, Courtney's got a shot. Robert's got a long shot. I've got a shot. Hagen's car's real fast. Got me last night in qualifying. And I like a fight, and I'm in a dogfight, and that's when John Force is his best, and I'm going to give it everything I got.
Look out for John Force today. He has John Capps in the first round.
Big time sponsorship announcement, though, made by the 16-time champion. We'll tell you about that later in the show. Right now, it's about Bob Vandergriff and Richie Crampton on the racetrack. Bob Vandergriff, now just two races left in his career. Stepping out, Dave Conley getting in the seat there. Going to be a two-car team with Larry Dixon. Then there's Richie Crampton, the U.S. Nationals winner. With all of that momentum, though, Mike, has just one round win in the countdown after winning the Labor Day race.
But the car looks better than it has since that win in the U.S. Nationals, running very well. We talked about on our E3 show, one guy would not want to come up against in elimination. That's Richie Crampton, because Aaron Brooks is crew chief. You never know what he's going to throw at you. He could be struggling to throw out the low ET of the meet at any time. Oh!
Supercharger goes askew on the top of Bob Vandergriff's car, and he is now down to one race left in his career. Crampton goes 3.80, 3.1. You got to believe Aaron Brooks was looking for a little bit more there.
Well, we saw Bob Vandergriff's teammate Larry Dixon blow the engine about the same point. It was a little bit different type of explosion here. It looked like more knocked the supercharger off. Maybe not quite as much damage to the bottom end, at least we're hoping. Richie Crampton, though, he was there for the taking. Bob had 300ths of a second advantage off of the starting line, but unfortunately couldn't make it to the finish under power, and Richie Crampton got the win.
The top three qualifiers from our NHRA Mellow Yellow Stop. The Toyota Nationals come up in the next three pair. J.R. Todd, the number one qualifier, takes on T.J. Zizzo. Then Spencer Massey races Terry McMillan. And Doug Coletta, whose season looks oh so promising earlier this year, will take on Brittany Force in her Rookie of the Year car. The marquee matchup, though, can Billy Torrance keep the dream alive for his son Steve Torrance, Sean Langdon, and Doug Coletta? To do so, he will have to take out that man, Tony Schumacher.
The NHRA Toyota Nationals is brought to you by Mellow Yellow. Go on yellow. Toyota, let's go places. And McDonald's, I'm loving it.
Nobody has more funny car wins at the Toyota Nationals, the strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, than Ron Capps. Four times. Keep it together today. He hopes to grab his fifth. Keeping it together, that was a problem for a Windy City racer we haven't seen since September. T.J. Zizzo makes his first appearance since debuting a new sponsor at the U.S. Nationals. Well, during that event, the Ziz made a number of good, consistent runs, including a career-best 3.79 and qualified him 11th. But it was this huge explosion in the first round against Bob Vandergriff that got all the attention. T.J. breaks down what broke down, some of the parts that were damaged, and what caused the explosion in the Traxxas Extreme Power Session.
Here's an intake manifold that is ready to run for this weekend. This is a piece of the manifold that came flying off our race car at the U.S. Nationals. What we got here is a supercharger case. This supercharger case is ballooned, so it is no longer usable. It will be used as a mailbox, or we will put it on our show car. This here is a supercharger snout. There is a shaft in here which drives the supercharger, which drives off the belt. This is the one that flew off the car. This is what caused all that damage. That is a camshaft. It broke, of course, as you can see. And when it broke, it filled up the combustion chambers with fuel, because the fuel pump is still running on that race car. As soon as there was some combustion in one of those chambers, it blew out the manifold, and that's what blew this apart. To fix this problem on a camshaft, we have learned about fatigue on these camshafts now. We're running new cylinder heads. They're stage 7. They make a ton of horsepower. What is happening is we need to replace that more often. We'll replace it after 15 runs. And that's what the engine should look like when it comes back from the run.
And when the camshaft is still in one piece, all of the valves are opening and closing properly, which allows the fuel and air mixture to combust efficiently. That's how you produce 10,000 horsepower, and that's what it takes to get a Wally. Here is T.J. Zizzo with his brand new Rust-Oleum colors, anchoring the quickest top fuel field in NHRA history this weekend. At the Toyota Nationals, on the other end of the spectrum, the number one qualifier, J.R. Todd, with his career best 3.73, 2-second pass. Well, tonight on SportsCenter, the day has arrived for Lauryn Hill's first and perhaps final college basketball game, but her mission is only beginning. Tom Rinaldi shares her inspiring message in a moving story of triumph in the midst of tragedy. One more game, a new SportsCenter feature premiering tonight at 11 o'clock Eastern time. She, a Mount St. Joseph basketball player with terminal brain tumor in her head, and that's why J.R. Todd is recognizing the fellow Lawrenceburg, Indiana native on the front of his car.
And no, he did not. JR holds on.
Whole shot.
Car was chewing itself up. Look at the mile an hour on Todd. Connie knows his Optima Batteries team just dodged a bullet there.
Yeah, JR had almost 200-second advantage off the starting line. Picked up another three by the eighth mile. But then you're going to see the blower belt look like it starts chewing itself up. It noses over just before the finish line. You take a look at the Lucas Oil photo finish cam, how fast TJ Zizzle was closed in, but just came up a little bit short.
Well, this has the makings of possibly being a Cinderella-type weekend as far as the Doat Racing team and Leah Pritchett are concerned. We talked about the fact a career-best qualifying effort, the announcement from Gemout over the weekend that they're expanding their involvement for next season. How much better can it get for you and your guys?
Three rounds better is what it could get, but right now all the glory goes to God. He's blessed me with an amazing crew and team and opportunities throughout my life to be here. And this round win right there was dedicated to FX Caprera, one of our sponsors that just recently passed away. And this is for him. And to, you know, end our season on this note is awesome. And I'm just beyond, you know, over the top, beyond the moon. And I have three more rounds to go. And it's race day. And this is what I live for.
See you in round two.
Thank you.
Up next in top fuel elimination, Spencer Massey taking on Terry McMillan. For Spencer, this is a brand new car, his first totally brand new car in 2 years. They were not going to bring it out until testing in the offseason, but since they're out of championship contention, Spencer says, hey, we might as well get a jump on next year. So consider the last few races a test. So far, so good. He qualified number two.
And then in qualifying number two, the car went down the racetrack on all four runs. They might be thinking now they should have brought it up to begin the countdown.
Best start of the season for Spencer. Takes on Terry McMillan. No round wins here. And now his fifth prior start. He's 0-9 racing the Red Fuel Dragster.
Oh, Spencer dodged the bullet.
There, you heard all the screaming on the radio. Terry McMillan's crew let him know something wasn't right with that car. Get out of it before you make a big-time explosion.
Yeah, I'm Terry McMillan. Obviously, he runs on a limited budget, so the crew member had a cylinder out, and he's telling him to shut off to save the parts.
And he layeth the smacketh down a 398 last night. Tells everybody here that you are approaching this as the hunter once again, like you did in Maple Grove.
Yeah, I mean, we got a great race car and a great crew working on it, but, you know, everybody wants to talk about the pressure, and, you know, what really put it in perspective for me yesterday was watching that Make-A-Wish kid go down through there and win his first Wally. Man, what we do, I mean, it's great, and I love doing it, but it don't mean nothing compared to seeing a kid like that put a smile on his face. So we're going to do the best job we can out here, and, you know, and we'll deal with the pressure the best way we can, but I'm enjoying the situation. You know, it's an opportunity out here. You got to look at pressure like, you know, the door's open, let's walk through it. So I feel good about it. You know, we just got to go race our race car and hopefully turn on four wind lights. If not here, we'll do it in Pomona.
Lay it the smack down. I think Bruno's staying over at the Excalibur this weekend, isn't he?
Wow.
That's good stuff by the two-time Comp World champ.
Well, right now with Brittany Force and Doug Coletta, big matchup here. Let's talk about lane choice real quick. It doesn't matter. Guy's been taking the right lane. Guy's been taking the left-hand lane. We've seen good runs in both of them.
And a big moment for Doug. Can he stay in the championship race?
Oh, no!
Knock him out, and she just did.
Nice run.
378.9 for Brittany, carrying that Rookie of the Year body, a theme all her own. Says when she gets under the cockpit there, she feels like in a fighter jet. She just shot down Big Red.
Take another look at it. Doug had a slight advantage off the starting line, was pulling away to the 330, but right about that point, that's when the big Goodyear slick started to spin. That was all she wrote for Doug Coletta and his season. Tough play.
And in the year of the woman, it will be Brittany Force taking on Leah Pritchett in the upcoming second round here today in Las Vegas. Well, coming up, look who's on the line next. He knows Doug has fallen to the wayside, but Tony Schumacher and a quest to get his eighth Top Fuel Championship will be the next pair when we come back to the Toyota Nationals, the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway.
The NHRA's playoffs are on. Down to the championship. That's NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing.
In the history of the NHRA, few names have graced the record books as often as Tony Schumacher. He's first on the all-time Top Fuel wins list, and his seven career championships are the most ever in the class. Throughout his career, Schumacher has been nearly unstoppable. But he hit a rough patch at the end of 2013 into the early part of this season, winning just once over a 22-race stretch.
But Schumacher's team have once again found their stride when it matters most during the NHRA's countdown to the championship. They've won three of four races, and Tony sits on the brink of an unprecedented eight Top Fuel championship. Tony Schumacher comes to the line today at the Toyota Nationals. He will take on Billy Torrence in our Harley-Davidson marquee matchup. In this position to win that eighth championship because he's won three of the last four races. How has he done that, Mike?
Well, it's all about the performance. The car has run well all season long, but the turning point for this team was Denver when they went out there and decided to back it up, and they got upset in the first round after qualifying number one. They said, we're not going to do that again. We're going to get aggressive, and that car's performance has been outstanding since then. They've won three of the four countdown races coming into this race in Las Vegas.
His opponent is Billy Torrence. Stat guy Lewis Bloom with more.
The key stat is that Tony Schumacher, if you want the championship to move on, has got to lose first round at this race. He's been here 13 prior times, and it's only happened just once.
Two drivers with both career best speed numbers, but it's not about speed or ET. It's about crossing that finish line first, something Tony knows oh so well. With 700 round wins, going after 701, Billy Torrence has won two times in his career, two round wins.
Hey,
David Goliath.
This is drag racing. You never know what can happen.
Look at that!
Oh, did it happen? Yes, it did!
Wow!
Billy Torrence just knocked out Tony Schumacher. The championship will not be run and won today.
Oh, man!
Listen to the crowd.
Boy, he did his boy proud, didn't he? Billy Torrence did the job all the way down the entire
first,
run.
Yep.
And Richard Hogan, great tune-up on that race car. I think Tony Schumacher's going to be kicking himself. I think he took Billy a little for granted. 085 light. He's been much better that during the countdown. I think he might have just went up there and said, played it just a little bit too safe. But give credit where credit is due. That was a great pass.
Reaction at the starting line, very, very positive, as you might expect. The Lucas Oil photo finish cam will show you that Billy Torrence, by just that much, means that all four of the NHRA Mellow Yellow Championships will be awarded in 2 weeks at the 50th Auto Club Finals. Get your tickets now.
Steve Torrence has said all along, we're going to get our dad in here. He's going to play a key role in our championship hopes. And Billy, you have just delivered, I don't know if you call it a stunning upset. You evaluate the significance of this win.
How about them Capco boys? No guarantees in this stuff. I mean, that's the top of the heap right there. And, you know, we just brought our A game.
Indeed you did. Well done.
Thank you.
You saw Billy's wife, Kay. Of course, that's Steve's mom. Very proud moment for her. Now see if she can get her son a little further down the road, too. Sean Langdon is Alan Abi Silver, the outgoing champion. And this is Steve Torrence, Billy's son, in the same exact lane where his dad just shocked the Top Fuel world by knocking out the Sarge. The points, they will be a change in a little bit. We already know that Doug is been knocked out today. Steve, though, golly, stat guy's already crunching numbers. Go the distance today. He can get within 66 of Schumacher, make it a little bit more interesting when we get to Pomona.
Well, and I tell you, the door is just slightly open now for Steve Torrence and Sean Langdon. It's important for both of these drivers to try to get the win. But I tell you what, Steve Torrence has got to be pumped after seeing his dad do that. I mean, that's got to get, and I know as a driver, that would fire me up when I see something like that happen. It's like, okay, now let's focus on doing our job.
As a driver, do you ever pay attention to trends in the guys that you race? The only reason I bring it up is Steve Torrence has lost to Sean Langdon the last five times they've matched tough head-to-head.
You know, I'm always aware of guys that whoop me a lot. I don't keep track of the actual numbers, but like Bernstein and Selzy, I knew when I came against them, these guys whoop me on a regular basis, but you never gave up.
Torrence, the highest driver in the points without a race win. He's actually got a winless streak that goes back to 36. No better time than right now to change that. Oh, but Steve is up in smoke, and it's Sean Langdon.
Nice run.
That will have the opportunity to close that gap down. He goes 377, 318 miles an hour.
Tony Schumacher watching that, of course, with great interest. Well, give us your evaluation of the situation to the moment.
Oh, you know what? We had a great race car, and they just did what they had to do to beat me. Obviously, you know, Billy was going to help his son win a championship, so they did what they had to do to beat us. Kind of did our calm, cool first round thing, typical run, and we got beat, you know.
You didn't take him for granted, did you?
Oh, absolutely not. No. Just you're definitely not going to red light when you got a car that's running so much better. You know, a good 80 light, and he went quicker. Now, he beat us, and, you know, it's coming out here, and Steve-O's from Texas, so it's kind of hoping he'd pull that win off, but it doesn't matter. You know, three of the guys right behind me went out, and old Langdon's the only one left.
Thanks, Tony.
You got it.
Sean Langdon now up to second in the points, can pull within 74 of Tony Schumacher should he win the event. The Lucas Oil ladder for Top Fuel looking forward to the second round. You can best believe that Sean Langdon's team manager, AJ's focused.
Yeah, and for Spencer Massey, teammate of Tony Schumacher, he can really help him out by taking out Sean Langdon.
Well, that means it's time for Funny Car. Matt Hagan is rolling his Mopar Express Lane car closer to the starting line. His championship contender in the points battle is John Force. This one's been setting itself up since the beginning of the year.
I want to take out those Force cars. That's what I dream about.
That is the new national laps time record.
I know that kid over there, Hagan, he's a Hulk, but I got to tell you, Jimmy Prock just flexed his muscles.
He's given two of my championship speeches already, and I don't plan on it being the third this year.
Ah, but Jimmy Prock is gone, and Dickie Venables has that man, Matt Hagan, running on mean. Funny Cars next in Las Vegas. College. The NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing Series under the bright lights and the big sun in the sky today at the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway for the Toyota Nationals, where the Lucas Oil Ladder and Funny Car will show you Matt Hagan is the number one qualifier. He has got a great matchup with Terry Haddock as Ron Capps qualified fourth. He has won four times here at the Strip.
All my eyes are going to be focused on that matchup between Jack Beckman and Robert Hyde. Jack Beckman has Robert's old crew chief Jimmy Prock calling the shot.
Best start of the year for Jeff Ferren, a career best for a Jim Dunn-driven race car, but the Allo car up in smoke at the hit. Del Worsham goes the distance. 2 years driving the DHL Funny Car, still looking for that first win. One round closer, she goes 4-11.
And with Sean Langdon. Okay, Schumacher on the trailer. How much has that revitalized your hopes? He still looks like a long shot.
It is a long shot, but when you're racing for Shea Khaled and Alan Johnson and got Brian Heason as my crew chief, that's all you need. You just need a little bit of a chance, and we got that now with 1, 2, and 3 going out in the points, and obviously with Schumacher going out, you know, as soon as he went out, Alan turned around at me, and he gave me that head nod and that little fist pump. So that was all I needed right there, man. I'm glad to be a part of this team, glad to have an opportunity at this Mellow Yellow Championship. Again, that was a good feeling last year. 148 points going into the weekend behind Schumacher. Anything will help. We just got to get it closed down. We got to finish the job here, but more importantly, we got to finish it out in Pomona, too.
Thank you.
Yeah, we've never seen this movie before where Alan Johnson comes from behind and wins the championship.
There are the points of the moment. He was fourth coming in, and he can gain 60 more and make this a lot more interesting when we get to Pomona, a lot more interesting for the fans and everybody except, of course, Tony Schumacher. We turn our attention now to Ron Capps, who comes up against Tony Pedregon. Four wins at this second race in Las Vegas, the fall race, the most of any Funny Car driver. He had a career-best speed pass yesterday on a breezy Saturday evening. He will race Tony Pedregon, whose last win came in Brainerd 2009 over Ron Capps.
Yeah, that breezy always helps when it's a tailwind, and we saw some big speed yesterday. But for Ron Capps right now in front of this huge crowd here in Las Vegas, seems like him and Ron Tolbert really like running here. They always run well, and they made four very good runs in qualifying to qualify in that number four spot. The tricky spot might be at the hit of the throttle. We've seen a couple cars spin early.
Johnny with problems right away. The left lane, no problem. The Napa know-how crew, Ron goes 4:14.5. At 313 miles an hour. That is Ron Tolbert, the man who calls the shots. Well, in 2 weeks, the 2014 NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing season concludes as we hand out all four championships at the 50th Auto Club NHRA Finals, the golden anniversary, the times you see on your screen. Starting today, fans can vote for their favorite moment from the last 50 years of the Auto Club NHRA Finals by heading to NHRA.com or NHRA's Facebook page. The number one choice going to be revealed in Pomona. Voting ends Tuesday, November the 11th. Earlier, Bruno Massel caught up with one of those Funny Car Countdown Championship contenders.
Well, Courtney, we haven't started eliminations yet today, but you're already fouling to yourself down another round against Matt Hagan. Does that change your outlook on today?
There's nothing we can do about it. You know, we tried to do the best we could during qualifying and get those points, but he just got enough to make it another round. So it's going to make it that much harder, but, you know, our team's up for the challenge. Might be a little bit of a long shot going for this championship, but, you know, we're going to do whatever we can. You never know what can happen, and we're just hoping to go some rounds today and hopefully move on up that ladder. But we're trying to stay three or at least improve, so we'll do the best we can.
Well, there's been a lot of talk about crew chiefs and sponsors and a lot of distraction. Has that affected your team at all today?
No, I don't think so. I mean, honestly, I think it's been great announcements teaming up with Peak and Blue Death, and it's only positive things coming out of John Force Racing, and I think that's something to definitely keep smiling about. So we're going to go out here with our heads on straight and keep our focus and hopefully go some rounds today, both me and my dad.
Courtney, the runner-up here last year, drew her dad when he clinched that 16th title. But John Force came back to Las Vegas in the spring, and he took on Paul Lee driving Gary Densham's car. And guess what? Paul Lee knocked him out. Now Paul's going to try to do the same thing to Courtney.
As you take a look at John, he's the next pair up, watching his daughter right in front of him. Courtney Force has run well here in Las Vegas. Von Douglas, crew chief, really seems to like this facility. Lane choice, same thing, funny cars, what we saw on Top Fuel. They're going back and forth. Nobody really seems to know which lane they like best. I think they're probably looking at their records. I'd speculate that Ron Douglas went back and said, hey, you know, we went out and made a decent pass in that first session in the right lane because their best pass was in the left lane, but the conditions were outstanding when they ran that one.
Paul Lee drives for the Teachers Pet. For more on Gary Densham, here's the stat guy.
Yeah, Gary Densham turned 68 this month. Unfortunately, had some knee surgery. They had to go back in. He really wanted to drive this week. He hired Paul Lee, who's done well in the race car. He hopes to be back to race at the Pomona at the 50th anniversary finals.
After back-to-back wins in Dallas and St. Louis, Courtney lost round one at Maple Grove. She's going to have a shot at running for this championship. She cannot duplicate that now against Paul Lee.
Oh, what she did! Paul Lee has just pulled a big upset over Courtney Force. Number three in the funny car points is out in round one.
Oh, boy. How about Gary Densham, the former John Force driver there, sometimes gives John fits. He loves Gary, but I'll tell you what, the crafty old guy knows how to get a race car down the track. Remember, he went the final round at Seattle and looked up, had a very good race car. Well, I'll tell you what, first round, that was a great job by Paul Lee and that team to get the win. It was convincing.
How about Paul Lee? Two round wins this season, the first one coming in the spring over John Force, the second one back here in Las Vegas over Courtney. Wow. Well, the next pair will feature Courtney's dad, John Force, in his quest to win his 17th championship. To do that, he's got to take out John Capps. And an upset alert, sure to upset either Fast Jack Beckman or Robert Hite, but it is Fast Jack that has the services of Jimmy Prog. You know Jimmy'd love to get a win against his old team.
Even though he is just overseeing the tune-up run by Chris Cunningham, you know there's a lot going on with Robert Hite there. A big relationship between those two. Coming up next, you're not going to want to miss it here in Las Vegas.
I want to take out those Force cars. I mean, that's what I'm here to do, you know. That's what I dream about, you know. And he's given two of my championship speeches already, and I don't plan on it being a third this year.
Two times in a career that does include the 2011 Funny Car Championship, Matt Hagan has been a runner-up to 16-time Funny Car Champion John Force. And each of those off seasons were spent the same way, back home on the farm or in a gym, getting stronger, plotting a course for revenge, and counting down the days to right or wrong. At the season opener in Pomona, Hagan had a chance to do just that, but once again finished runner-up to John Force. But a true cowboy doesn't quit when the going gets tough. He dusts himself off and gets back to work, and that's exactly what Matt Hagan did. In the first race of the countdown, it was Hagan and Force back in the final round for the first time since they met at the Winter Nationals. This time, Hagan came out on top. And his winning ways continued three races later in Reading. He took the points lead and is in the hunt to become a two-time NHRA Mellow Yellow Funny Car World Champion.
Yeah! Yeah! Woo!
Well, as we welcome you back to the strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, that is John Capps. John Capps now ready to race John Force in the American-made 16-time champ collectible car.
head-to-head this year, John Force versus Matt Hagen. Numbers very, very comparable. The one that sticks out, though, is look where John began the countdown. Look where Matt did.
Yeah, Matt Hagen really had a great car in the countdown. And John pretty much had a great car all season. But right now, the advantage has to go to Matt Hagen. Talk about having that momentum and peaking at the right time. Matt's definitely doing it.
Well, if there's a defining moment of the countdown so far for John Force, if he comes up short, it could be the Carolina Nationals final at Dallas, where it looks like John is driving away from Matt Hagen. The only problem is John turned on the red light. Hagen celebrates, and he's now the point leader with just two eliminations Sundays left.
I changed my routine. I know better than to change my routine. This makes me so furious at myself. You don't change your routine. And I changed it, and I screwed up all the work we did trying to win this race. We're going to try to win this championship, and you do not win it by making those kind of mistakes.
And it's a routine changed again because Jimmy Prock's not calling the shots.
Boy, ain't that the truth.
John Force, keep pace. Big moment in the Funny Car Championship battle. Yes, he can. American made and answered loud and proud. 4085, 318 miles an hour. John Force is into the second round. He will race the winner of Bob Tasca, Tim Wilkerson.
Well, I'll tell you what, the team rose to the occasion. John went up there and had a good reaction time. Didn't leave anything on the table for John Capps. And then the team put together a great pass. 408, low ET of eliminations thus far. That's a nice way to get into the second round.
How humbling is this sport, Courtney?
Well, that's the name of the game. I mean, that's why I got into this sport. It's exciting. You never know what can happen, but, you know, it's unfortunate the way today went so far for my team. You know, I'm proud of my guys. They put in a lot of hard work on this car, and we still got Pomona, but you know what? I'm bummed out right now. I really wish we could have gotten that win, obviously, for my Traxxas team, for all my sponsors, Castrol, Ford, Auto Club, Brand Source, Mac Tools, Peak, all these guys that came on board supporting us and all of us here at John Force Racing. Appreciate what you guys do. We're working hard out here. We weren't able to get the job done today, but we're going to look forward to Pomona, and hopefully we can stay in that top three because that's our goal right now, and we'll see if we can get some damage done in Pomona because that's the best that we can do right now. But thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And now we come to the point leader, Matt Hagen. The next matchup is he will take on Terry Haddock. Spotlight on Dickie Venables, Matt Hagen's crew chief. On Friday after the first qualifying session, we wired him up as he tries to tune Matt to a second world championship.
It ran about 200 or 300 slower than what I was thinking, but I think probably everybody did. It's hard to make power. You know, you come from a place like Reading where the air is real good, you get up in this altitude, all you can do is you got to kind of go off your first run. You know, we just missed it a little on the tune-up. It's just a little soft, but it went down the track, so we're happy with that. Here we're checking for rings that are collapsed or tight. We're looking for any scuff on the piston, any chips on the rings, which is an indicator of being too hot. Basically, it looks like it didn't run, so which it should for that kind of elapsed time. So we've got a, basically what we do is just tune it up now. We can get after it because it looks good.
And Jimmy did get after it, 398.3, a career best. That tied for the sixth quickest ever. $10,000 going to the Honor Flight Network. And coming up, we got a great feature as Cruz Pedregon took one of those flights.
Well, we talked about that, you know, when he was talking about that first session being soft, he was still third quick of that session. The Friday night session, he was second quick, and then he was the quickest of the final two. This car just kept getting better and better.
Matt Hagen has not lost in the first round the last 11 events. Taking on a guy, Terry Haddock, who has four career round wins spread out between Top Fuel and Funny Car. Team will do some testing. We expect to see Jenna Haddock back at the Auto Club Finals in a couple of weeks. Right now, I know John Force is pulling for Terry. Give me a shot, kid.
Yeah, it would definitely be a big upset, but I'll tell you what, first round jittered. I don't care how much of an advantage you think you have. You're always on your toes.
Can Hagen keep pace now?
Yep.
Oh, yeah. Boom, 407.3.
There you go.
That's now low elapsed time of the opening round. This team really looks very calm, very cool, and certainly very confident.
John, you always talk about how you battle best when your back's against the wall. Are you in trouble at all?
I've been in trouble my whole life. That's when I do my best, because I've had a lot of practice. No, Brain Trust has taken over. Mike Neff leads that charge. John Medlin right there on the motor, right on the start line, and every other crew chief and backup crew chief that can help. My team is doing a great job. They stayed here with me, so I'm excited. I got the heart. I got the burn in my heart. I just needed a little energy. And I'll tell you, next to this mellow yellow, Courtney going out, I hate to see it. She's in that championship run. But boy, that fired me right up. That's what John Force needed, a little kick that I fight for my children and I fight for my team and the fans and the sponsors and Castle and Ford all the years. I love you. Auto Club, Traxxas, Mac Tool, and now Peaks on board. God bless all of you. Keeping me in business.
Force and Hagen on the opposite sides of the ladder. And for Matt Hagen, the next task for him, get past the second round, something he hasn't been able to do at the strip the last 3 years. Toyota Nationals continue in a moment. The NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing Series, Shake of the Desert here at the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway at the Toyota Nationals. Funny car eliminations continue now with the Patron XO Cafe upset alert, a matchup between Robert Height, Jack Beckman, and a whole lot of sub stories.
Oh, there's so many. Where do we start? Fast Jack Beckman, even though we outqualified him, we picked him as an upset. It's more their feelings might be upset, exactly. More so than this is, it's going to be kind of a surprise. I don't think there'll be any surprise. One of the reasons Robert Height, he's won five times this season. Jimmy Prock, Robert Height, and that team, Mike Neff, knows what this man is capable of doing. Jack Beckman's still trying to get his first win since winning the championship in 2012. He's hoping Jimmy Prock can lead him to that.
Prock very successful at John Force Racing, but now would like to see Fast Jack perhaps get his first win in a couple of years. Green lights for both.
Look at that.
Robert Height drive
Man.
Away.
409-1.
And I'll see your upset alert and flush it. Jimmy Prock, of course, dealing from a different side, moving to a team with an entirely different combination, working with Chris Cunningham. Couldn't figure out a way to take out Mike Neff and Robert Height.
I think we made them mad. That Neff ran that well, because they struggled to qualify. Went down the track very nicely on Friday and then struggled yesterday, but came out and made a nice pass.
Championship points leader Matt Hagen taking care of business in the first round. Once you've done that, how much does that settle you down as far as the rest of the day is concerned?
I mean, there's always that drive. I mean, I was more worried about Terry over there. I mean, he wanted to wish his boy happy birthday, you know, on TV, and he's like, man, I just want to beat you so I can do that. So you got some, that's like karma against you right there, you know. So hopefully he gets that opportunity. But anyway, we just got to keep focused and keep worrying, keep working hard, and it'll all come into play. And, you know, just hopefully keep this distance, you know what I mean? As you've seen in first round there with Tony Schumacher, anything can happen, and we understand that. I've had to horn before by the bull, but you can't be scared to crawl back in the pen with him.
I like the analogy. Thanks.
Matt, you just took care of that birthday greeting for Terry Haddock. That'll bring us down to Bob Task and Tim Wilkerson. And a reminder that no other night is Monday night, as the Colts offense is on fire, ranked first in total offense, second in scoring, averaging more than 31 a game. But the Giants defense lead the NFC with 11 interceptions. It's Monday Night Football, the Colts versus the Giants at 8:15 on ESPN. Now to Tim Wilkerson and Bob Tasca, who once had an alliance working together with their Ford Mustangs. Tim Wilkerson has yet to start a countdown race with Lane Choice, but despite that, Mike, he does have four round wins in the countdown.
And that was early in the countdowns. Remember, he came into the end of the countdown in the number 10 spot, and he was starting to make a move and then kind of fizzled out after the first couple races.
Bob Tasca, meanwhile, though, has been a spoiler in the countdown. With countdown round wins over Cruz Pedregon, did not qualify. That was a big surprise this weekend as well. Ron Capps, John Forsey also put on the trailer during the countdown.
Mark Denner, crew chief for Bob Task, has been doing a good job. They've really been spending a lot of time in the bell housing, working on that clutch, trying to get the thing consistent. They're not worried about making the big runs, you know, the horsepower type runs and the run the big number. They said, first, we've got to get this thing down the track to get some good information. They've been doing that.
Tim Wilkerson, no round wins here the last 4 years.
Wow.
I'd like to turn that around here. So he's got a couple of streaks that are starting to get to be a little long.
A little mini staging duel.
cylinder out for Tasca. Whoa! Timmy Dodge won there.
And it wasn't pretty, but a fifth round win from the bottom side of the qualified ladder. Tim Wilkerson now.
Oh, that was lucky.
Admits it. Yep, he says that was lucky.
It looked like he had a pretty narrow tire track. Drove into smoke.
Now take a look at on the left side of your screen, Tasca, with that cylinder out. You might ask, well, why would it smoke the tires on seven cylinders? Because what happens is the engine doesn't rev up, that centrifugal clutch, it grabs it too early, it's not slipping enough, and then it goes right up in tire smoke, just screws the whole run up.
We saw number one qualifier J.R. Todd survive first round. When this happened, the team stripped the blower belt. He won on a hole shot. Well, back in the pits, the guys are doing pretty much normal work back on servicing this engine. What they come to find out after talking with crew chief James Riola is the fact that it dropped a cylinder number two about 2.8 seconds in. That's what caused it to gut the blower belt. But these guys know they have to get after it because they've got a tough round two opponent in Khaled Belushi.
Thank you very much for that, Bruno. Great to see the work going on back in the pits. When we come back, the final pair of funny car, which features Alexis DeJoria and Tommy Johnson Jr. He and his Make-A-Wish organization granting a big-time wish to a 17-year-old out of Nebraska. It'll bring a tear to your eye when we come back to the tour. There was a momentous occasion yesterday on the NHRA Mille Yellow Drag Racing Series as Tommy Johnson Jr., Terry Chandler, and the Make-A-Wish crew granted a wish to 17-year-old Austin Zimmerlein. He wanted to be a race car driver and win a race for a team. He suffers from cerebellum atrophy and cerebral palsy, but teamed up with TJ, they took on Fast Jack Beckman and Antron Brown, both champions of the sport. And thanks to Doug Foley, who gave Austin hand control to work the throttle for this championship battle.
Ah, look at Austin and TJ get the whole shot advantage over the champions. And look at that, they're pulling away for the win. How about that? Great job.
That a kid, Austin, at the top end, got the special Wally, got the hat, got the mellow yellow, and even better than all of that, got an interview with Gary Gerald.
Well, talking over winning strategy, the real pilot here is Tommy Johnson, Austin Zimmerlein. He's got himself a Wally. What a magical moment. TJ, tell us about what this experience is like for you and your passenger.
For me, it's been phenomenal, but mine doesn't even come close to what Austin just experienced here, but it does come close to be able to help grant a wish for Austin. He wanted to be a race car driver and win a trophy for his team, and we just went 146, almost 147 miles per hour. Austin just won his team a trophy.
Awesome. Austin, what did it feel like to go that fast to get that wallet?
It felt like a million bucks.
A million bucks. I love that. And tears of appreciation from Mom. Mikey, what's it like to see your son experience this moment?
It's amazing. Amazing, truly amazing.
$1 million right
there. This is wonderful for him.
Give me a fist bump on $1 million right there, pal. Good job. Good job.
Oh, and Austin, nothing but the best for you. Not a dry eye in the house. Everybody standing up, applauding what was a really, really great occasion by Terry Chandler and that entire Make-A-Wish organization. Now Tommy Johnson would like to make a wish come true with at least a round win here against Alexis DeJoria, who did bring out the Mamavan this weekend. Free mammograms for every woman 40 or older to purchase the ticket to this event. If you didn't get it done here, don't worry. We got a rain check slip for you to make sure that you get on the right side of breast cancer.
Well, right now it's a little bit of a surprise that these are your number 8 and 9 qualifiers. Alexis won the race here in the spring. Tommy DeLago had a very good tune-up on the car, and the car's been running fairly well in the countdown. Also, Tommy Johnson Jr. coming off that final round in Redding. I thought both of these cars would come in here and run a little bit better than they have. They've run a 406, 407 to get that number 8 and 9 qualifying position. But I know both cars are capable of running more, but they just haven't been able to find the handle to do it just yet.
Jean-Paul DeJoria, her dad, philanthropist, on hand to see if Alexis can take down TJ.
Good race.
Oh, and TJ just nipped her at the finish line.
410. Whole shot.
Beats a quicker, but losing 408. You saw the raw fuel pouring out of DeJoria's right side. That's probably what cost her the race.
Well, I think being 300 of a second late off the starting line is what really cost her the race. Yeah, but she was probably ahead at that point, like you said, Dave, but then the cylinder dropped pretty early in the run. You take a look at the Lucas Oil photo finish cam, and by just a nose, Tommy Johnson
Jr. is able to advance to the second round.
Back-to-back races, Alexis DeJoria has unfortunately been on the wrong side of a whole shot loss. He thought perhaps she was on her way, but the scoreboard says different. Tommy Johnson Jr. got the win. So the Lucas Oil Ladder looking forward now to the second round of Funny Car. Sees that Tommy Johnson Jr. is a round attempt against Matt Hagan, the number one man in the Funny Car points. And number two, John Force will race Tim Wilkerson. The countdown to the Funny Car Championship continues today in Las Vegas. Time now to turn our attention to Pro Stock. Tense moment yesterday for Derek Kramer. Watch the car on the left side of your screen.
Derek trying desperately to get into the field, but boy, he got it way out of the marbles, got it loose, and put it on his lid.
He hit the left wall, came back across, hit the right wall, and in an interview with Gary Gerrell, did admit he drove it just a little bit too far, and now he's got to put a race car back together again. Nice job by the Lazarus team, though, keeping that man safe. Pro Stock points, do or done line right underneath Dave Conley. This one's setting up to be fun down the stretch.
Shane Gray still in, so is Alan Johnson. Never know what can happen, but doesn't look good for him right now.
Hasn't been a great stretch drive for Jason Lyne, but he has been good enough and is in position for title number three. This year was all smiles for Jason Lyne. He was the Pro Stock points leader out of the gate after winning the season opener in Pomona, California. And although his next win didn't come for another 14 races, he clicked off three straight Wallys with wins in Sonoma, Seattle, and Brainerd, Minnesota. Those wins were enough to lock him into the number one spot heading into the countdown. A pair of runner-up finishes in two of the first four countdown events. Jason Lyne is still leading the points and the race to the Pro Stock Championship. And in just a few moments, we'll race Matt Hartford, but it all kicks off with Vincent Nobile and Roger Brogdon. Vincent, first out after losing the quickest side-by-side race on a whole shot, leaves a day early.
1,200s early. I gotta believe that was in the back of his mind, the fact that he lost the quickest side-by-side race at Maple Grove, had 3 weeks to think about it, because that was very uncharacteristic for Vincent.
Well, let's take this a step further. Why didn't Roger Brogdon not even leave?
Well, let's go on board right there. Oh, listen to that. It just doesn't sound right. He didn't even rev it up. He knew it was dead, and look what happened.
He went red. Do we have to go down?
He always staged the car.
Roger Brogdon, the Maple Grove winner.
No. Right? Okay, let's go. We got to get back.
Team fired up. Opportunity to go back to back. Roger doing it from the bottom half. The first guy to do that in Pro Stock in the last 2 years. So that will take us to Jonathan Gray and Greg Anderson. Jonathan, that kept Greg out of the countdown when he beat him in round one in Indy. And how about these reaction times? Greg 008, he's second.
How about that? But luckily for Greg, Jonathan Gray has some problems early. That's pushing the clutch. Greg Anderson gets the win with a 664 at 208 miles per hour.
Well, the man that was the runner-up to Roger Brogdon at Maple Grove is Alan Johnson, champion a couple of years ago, racing Chris McGahey, who skipped the Maple Grove event.
Talk about reaction times.
Nobody in a hurry there.
70 to 140. Alan Johnson gets the win with a 660 at 208 miles per hour.
Now the moment for Jason Lyne. Butterflies always in the first round, especially when you got a tricky opponent. Matt Hartford racing a Kenny Koretsky-owned Pontiac with power from Elite in the opposite lane.
Matt Hartford gets an advantage off the start line. Oh, he's giving him a race. Oh, but comes up short. Jason Lyne gets the win with a 660 elapsed time.
By the narrowest of margins, Jason Lyne now has gone 10 consecutive races without a first-round loss by just that much. Dave Conley's third in the championship standings. How many drivers have raced in both Pro Stock and Top Fuel in NHRA competition? Dave is going to make that switch next year, racing V Gaines, the runner-up last year here, to Shane Gray.
Look at V, 003 reaction time. Dave's going to have to run him down. Can he do it? Oh, he just barely does it. Margin of victory, just over 7 thousandths of a second.
The Lucas Oil photo finish cam shows you the Kymco car, the red one nearest you, by just that much beats the Kendall driver.
Jason Lyne contemplating numbers. You get Dave Conley in the next round. He has a slight advantage for lane choice. What will it take to protect that number one spot?
I got to win. Got to turn the wind light on. Simple as that. So we got our work cut out for us, but you know, that's the way it's supposed to be. It's not supposed to be easy to win. So and it definitely will not be today, that's for sure. But our Summit Camaro is doing good, and I just got to let my left foot on time, and everything will be okay.
Thanks, Jason.
Thank you.
Six red lights in 2014 for Jed Coughlin, the most recent of those at the U.S. Nationals. That is how Aaron Stanfield, the 19-year-old son of Greg Stanfield, took him out on that day. Greg has raced in finals at Las Vegas in Pro Stock Car and in Pro Stock Truck. Remember that category?
Long time ago. Aaron gets the advantage. But look at that power out of that Mopar. Jed Coughlin advances with great pass. 6.59.6 at 208 miles per hour to get the win.
Love going on board with Jeggy.
Watch how long he holds first gear. And then look how quick he goes. I love that. Second, third, and fourth come pretty fast.
One of the best in the business.
Dave Conley taking care of business. Now you get Jason Lyne and a great opportunity. Tell us about how this one may shake out.
It's a huge opportunity, and you know, when we looked at the ladder last night, it's I couldn't have drawn it up. If you'd have said, you know, Dave, draw you out a ladder and put people where you need them, this is the way it needs to be. This is for a championship. We control our own destiny. We have to go through Jason Lyne, and I wouldn't want it any other way. It should be a tough match. I'm just glad I got my old V. You tried putting it on me again.
Only a 003 light.
I can't get you, man. No matter what, I can't get you. Good job.
So we know 1 and 3 in the points has moved on. Can Erica Ender Stevens keep pace? She doubled back here in the spring, won the K&N Horsepower Challenge and the national event. This is Jeff Isbell making his pro stock debut in a new Jerry Haas car. The man who won Top Alcohol Dragster here in the spring of 2008 over Jim Whiteley fades. Erica goes the distance, 6.58.1.
Final pair, Shane Gray alongside Larry Morgan. Shane, your number two qualifier. He's been running very, very strong. See the advantage for Larry Morgan, but look at Shane Gray drive around him right away. Nice pass, not low of the round, a 6.59.2 at 209 miles per hour to get the win.
Defending champ here at Vegas, Shane Gray moves on.
With Erica Ender Stevens, as tight as the championship battle is and the pressure that goes along with it, what are your nerves like on race day when you go to the first round of eliminations?
You know, they were a wreck in Reading, and I decided, you know, I talked with Jim Jack and the RFC guys and Angel, former three-time champion, and I just decided to give it to God and just keep my faith and stay strong and go out here and have fun. Drama-free weekend, just racing, just getting down to business. You know, it definitely is stressful, but I'm trying to keep my mind off of it. I say a prayer before I get behind the wheel, and just let her rip. So I've got a really good Chevy Camaro, a really fast race car. Rick and Ricky Jones, my entire Elite Motorsports Royal Purple team are doing great. And it's a beautiful day for racing. I'm blessed to be here and I'm having fun. Thank you.
And why not when you go 6.58.1, which is low elapsed time of that round. That gives you lane choice against Roger Brocken. Dave Conley and Jason Lyne, how about that?
I'm not gonna wanna miss that. And then Shane Gray's gonna pick his lane over Greg Anderson, and Jed Coughlin and Alan Johnson, the teammates, gonna go at it with Jed picking the lane.
Well, the big story in Funny Car continues to be Jimmy Prock's move over to Don Schumacher Racing. That's not a surprise. What is? The fact the dynamic duo broke up during the countdown to the championship. It even shocked the man who tunes the Prock Rocket.
Well, like I said yesterday, I thought it was going to be at the end of the year, but he changed his mind. I guess it surprised me a little bit, but, you know, I wanted to finish the year, but it didn't work out that way, and you know, like I said, I just have to move on, and so does he. He did what he thought was the right thing, so, you know, like I said, that's fine.
Well, again, armed with the knowledge that Dave Conley has a big matchup with Jason Lyne upcoming and a Monday test session here in his new Top Fuel car, that begs the trivia question: how many drivers have raced in both Pro Stock and Top Fuel in NHRA competition? The stat guy, Lewis Bloom, has the answer.
The number would be 5. The most notable, Jed Coughlin Sr., Kenny Koretsky, who actually did it at the same event, and Bruce Larson. My favorite stat about Bruce, he's the only guy to race in Top Fuel, Funny Car, and Pro Stock, the former Funny Car champion.
Bruce is the man. That is a fact. Big matchup, Dave Conley, Jason Lyne in the second round upcoming from today's Toyota Nationals. Need to get away from the strip, Las Vegas Motor Speedway. But when the race is done here today at the Toyota Nationals, Lake Mead, that's a great spot to go hang out. Check out the Hoover Dam. That thing is absolutely spectacular. Napa Track Fact Time with Bruno Massel.
Well, the crew is getting the engine back together in the frame rails of Matt Hagan's Funny Car. Dickie Venables, the team seems to really be running on a rail right now. Any issues come up in the last round? I see you guys swap full engines. It looked like you were trying to hone a cylinder and just save that initial block.
Well, actually what happened was that engine's been in it all weekend, and it was time for it to come out, just a normal cycle. So we just put another short block in, just normal routine stuff. Everything looked good. You know, it's just a matter of getting in service and getting back up there. Everything looks good.
It looks like you guys have an all or nothing approach this weekend. Very aggressive. Are you going to continue that through the rest of the day?
Well, you know, I've learned throughout the years, you know, you do what you've been doing, you do what got you there, you know, and it may look like we're being aggressive, you know, but it's making good, safe runs as far as tire spin. So we're just doing what the track, you know, adjusting the track conditions and just racing it. Gas and go.
Sounds like the same story for the Harley-Davidson Screaming Eagle Vance and Hines team of Andrew Hines and Eddie Krawick. 10 of the 14 national event trophies belong in those guys' pits.
It's the do or all done line because it's over for everybody else, but the Harley's the only thing to determine is will it be Andrew or Eddie getting the championship.
We kick off round one highlights with Jerry Savoie, Sean Gann, Batman. That was not a costume for Halloween.
Oh, Batman red lights.
Jerry Savoie, the runner-up last year to Matt Smith, has just earned a round win with a 6.932 second elapsed time.
Next up, we got Chaz Kennedy and Angie Smith. Chaz Kennedy on the Star Racing Buell has really started to come around at the last race in Maple Grove. Angie knew it. She pushed the tree, gets the red light, hands the win over to Chaz Kennedy, who takes it down to the finish with a 697, 190 miles per hour to advance.
The only member of Matt Smith Racing team to win this year, Angie Smith. The only member of the Star Racing team this weekend, Chaz Kennedy, is on gel. Suffered a rare, unfortunate DNQ after nearly severing her Achilles tendon. Katie Sullivan's first ever start with Lane Choice. She just grabbed her first round win of racing in 2014. She beat Adam Arana. Now just one race left before he joins the Coast Guard.
Next up, it's Michael Ray with Jimmy Underdahl. Michael Ray back on his Buell that he had been riding over at George Price. And he qualified number three with that motorcycle. He's been running very well with an assist from Matt Smith. Jimmy Underdahl had the advantage off the starting line, but look at Michael Ray drive around for the win. Nice pass, 695 beats a 699.
That deserves a photo finish. And by just about a full bike length, give it to the bike on the near side of your screen, Michael Ray. Runner-up in the championship last year. That'll bring us to Eddie Krawick, who starts the day two rounds out of first, behind Andrew Hines and Hector Arana Jr. Jr., who ties his lowest career start, 13th. It has been a struggle this year. The red light means those struggles continue. Eddie takes the win, 6-8-8.
Next up, it's Hector Arana and Steve Johnson. Steve Johnson, 10th in the countdown coming in and had a great first couple of races, but has really struggled since hurting a couple of engines. Hector Arana, you see, starts pulling away as he gets the win easily over Steve Johnson, whose troubles continue. A 697 beats a 704.
Eddie Krawick, as the helmet came off, said that's the Harley that was kind of missing this weekend. What was the difference?
Flat Eddie. He helps us out. He gave us a tune-up. No, you know, we went one way last night and struggled a little bit and saw a trend of what my bike was and wasn't liking. So, you know, my crew chief, Matt Hines, went back, tweaked on it a little bit for first round. Great job. Hats off to him, you know. But the nice thing about it was that was a huge round for us because that pretty much solidifies Harley-Davidson going 1-2 into the final two races. And all I could say is, woo-hoo!
Well, it's a big-time round upcoming now for Andrew Hines as the three-time non-countdown champion starts today with that two-round lead over Krawick, looking to win his 350th round of racing against John Hall.
Big advantage for John Hall at the starting line. Is Andrew going to be able to run him down?
Oh, yes, he did by the narrowest of margins.
Barely. Margin of victory, just over 0.002 of a second. Take a look at the tail of the tape. That 6.5 hundredths of a second advantage off the starting line. Look how close it was at the stripe.
That saves Andrew Hines' opportunity to get that first countdown championship. The margin, wow, a scant 8 inches.
Final pair, Matt Smith alongside Scotty Polachek. Matt Smith been running very well in qualifying. Scotty coming off the runner-up finish in Maple Grove, where he got a couple lucky breaks in the first two rounds, but then ran well after that. But I don't know if he's going to be able to take out Matt, because Matt, as I said, been running strong this weekend, and it continues very nice. 694, 7 beat Scotty, 7 flat.
Andrew Hines had some serious making up to do, and you were able to get it done by the narrowest of margins, 0023. Did you at any point think you were in trouble?
I heard him over there. Obviously, I don't look over. That's one thing I don't do. I got blinders in my helmet, but I could hear him. You know, those V-twins are pretty loud in the other lane. So luckily, Matt gave me enough motorcycle to run around John there. That's a big deal. I was nervous. I saw Eddie win that first round. We got a big battle going between us. He's got a fast motorcycle. It's like I missed it on the tune-up on that one, but had just enough.
On to round two.
There are three Mike Dunn power-ranked riders on the top side. As you take a look at the Lucas Oil ladder heading to the next round, Andrew Hines is one of them. Eddie Krawick and Jerry Savoie matchup on the top side.
Bottom side, Matt Smith's going to pick his lane over Hector Arana Sr., and Michael Ray's got a very good motorcycle. Will pick his lane over Katie Sullivan.
The engine going back together in John Force's funny car for their second round matchup. The data looks good according to John Medlin, his crew chief this weekend. So nothing but routine maintenance in the turnaround. And as far as being back calling shots on race day, Medlin says he feels great about it. Just needs three more runs like the last one.
Well, Mike Dunn, if I know you, when you got your first Top Fuel round win, you probably celebrated. This is Ashley Sanford from Top Alcohol Dragster. Did you celebrate quite like this?
I look just like that, Dave.
Just like this?
Well, yeah. Not quite that good.
Will she make the move to Top Fuel one day? The NHRA Mellow Yellow Top Fuel round two is next. That is the NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing Series on full display today at the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, home of the Toyota Nationals. Second round of Top Fuel begins with the top three in points. On the trailer today, the Lucas Oil Ladder shows you that the number one qualifier, J.R. Todd, is still racing. But the big matchup and the big opportunity sits down in that 2-10 matchup between Sean Langdon and Spencer Massey.
A must-win for Sean Langdon, but right now on the starting line, we got the ladies, Brittany Force and Leah Pritchett. Great matchup here. They both ran well in the first round. Leah's been running outstanding. Consistent runs. Crew Chief Doug Cook over there. Rob Flynn's come on board to help out, and they have really been stepping up.
Big time karma track for her. She's never raced Top Fuel here until today, but she did win Pro Mod in 2011 over Danny Rowe right here at the Strip. Oh. Brittany stands it straight up, and guess who is going to the semis? It's Leah Pritchett and the Gum Out Gang. 384-6. Second semifinal for her in her career. Remember back in 2013, she went to the semis in Topeka before bowing out against Tony Schumacher. That can't happen today.
Well, for Leah Pritchett.
At least not to Tony.
Yeah, that's for sure. But for Leah Pritchett, this is a way to do it. You come out and announce that your sponsor, Gumout's, going to be involved more heavily next season, and then you show them the reason why. They're in the semifinals. Nice job.
All four of the NHRA championships will be decided at the last race in Pomona. The same story as the NASCAR Sprint Cup will be handed out at the last race. But the final round of the Eliminator round comes up next from Phoenix International Raceway. It's eight nations battle, but only four will advance to Miami. The Quicken Loans Race for Heroes 500 from Phoenix next Sunday at 2 o'clock Eastern. Jeff Gordon, the point leader, heading into this weekend at least. Time now to see if Khaled Belushi and J.R. Todd, which one of these will advance in the shadows of Las Vegas Motor Speedway in the oval that sits right across the street.
Well, I like this matchup. J.R. Todd, your number one qualifier. Khaled Belushi, number nine qualifier. But crew chief Jason McCullough, along with Joe Barlam, done a great job this week. And the car has been very consistent going down the racetrack. That's been key. Obviously, J.R. Todd, he can run the number when he gets it all together. And he may have to get around Khaled.
J.R. Todd, the rookie of the year in 2006. A very talented crop this year will be decided in the next couple of races. Right now, a great side-by-side battle. How about J.R. Todd? 3-triple-7.
Wow, nice run.
Only one time this year has the number one qualifier gone on and won the race. It happened at our last stop in Maple Grove. J.R. Todd has the opportunity to go back-to-back with that claim.
Great run by both teams. 285 miles per hour for both drivers. The eighth mile. That means the track conditions are good.
His debut for Conrad Coletta back here at this race in the spring gets the round win by about half a car length. JR moves on. Khaled is done for the day. Time now for a Grind Boss Fix It pit report. Earlier, Bruno Massel was back in the pits of Richie Crampton.
When the Nitro cars go from the ideal atmospheric conditions of Maple Grove to the elevation here in Las Vegas, they need to try and pick up the power, so to speak. And the way they do that is first looking at the supercharger. They're going to try and spin it faster to get more air inside of that engine. The other thing they're going to address is the compression ratio of the engine. So what they'll do is they'll look at the head gasket and they'll try and get something with a thinner head gasket. The whole idea is to increase that compression, get more of a squeeze in the combustion chamber. Thing is, if you go too thin with the head gasket, you have a situation where the engine's not going to want to seal properly. So they can look to other areas as well. Cylinder head, for example, look at the combustion chamber. They'll find a set that's got a smaller combustion chamber. That'll bring up the compression ratio. Also, take a look at the pistons. A lot of these guys will get pistons that have a taller dome on it. Now, we're talking fractions of an inch. That fractions of an inch can bring this thing up in compression ratio and give it more power. The whole idea, though, is finding the balance. You got to get the balance between overdrive and compression ratio. And I'll tell you something, there are a lot of teams here today getting the balance right because we have seen some big numbers on the board.
The man who makes that decision for Richie Crampton is Aaron Brooks. Of course, Richie, the first rookie Top Fuel driver to win Indy in 19 years. Larry Dixon, the last guy to do that. He did it in 1995. He is racing the man that took out Tony in round number one, Billy Torrance.
Bruno talked about that compression ratio. I tell you what, a lot of the teams struggled when we first came up here trying to figure that out. We saw a lot of oil downs. They've gotten a lot better handle on it. I'm talking all the teams, and we're seeing very good runs. Billy Torrance, one of those guys that made a great pass in the first round to get the lane choice over Richie Crampton. He's taking the left-hand lane, but based on that previous run, it doesn't make any difference. They're both good.
That was a career-best pass in both speed and ET that Billy did. He knocked out the Sarge. Now can he take down the Geico driver? Get to the semifinals. Great race, and yes, he will.
Drove around him.
Drives around the rookie Crampton at the top end of the race course. Billy goes 3.808 on that pass. And remember back when Richie won Indianapolis, the U.S. Nationals? Billy was his first round victim on that day. Billy, ounce of revenge right here.
Richie had 300ths of a second advantage off the starting line, but he started having problems in the middle of the racetrack. Slowed down. He's running 8 mile an hour slower at the 8th mile, and that's what cost him the win.
One more pair of Top Fuel cars, and then it's going to be all about Funny Car, the continuing countdown to the championship battle involving Matt Hagan, who enjoys a 41-point lead over the 16-time champ, who desperately wants the 17th, and of course, John Force. The Cackle Fest, the California Hot Rod Reunion. That's where Mike Dunn was the Grand Marshal. You're on board.
So Waterman in Hampshire, 1964, Top Fuel dragster, front motor. Never pushed out a car before. Sid Waterman did it, and I think fired up, and it was loud, and I got to hit the throttle a couple times. I'll tell you what, I was excited.
Got to take your granddaughter Kaylee with you. She was riding loud and proud.
She loved it. Got to ride in the parade and waved to all the people.
Great time, Hat, out in Bakersfield, California. I know I got to get out there. It's on my calendar, the to-do list next year for sure. Big matchup coming up between Spencer Massey and Sean Langdon. Langdon trying to stay involved in the countdown, but remember, back in 2009, it was Spencer Massey who delivered a special win here in Las Vegas, as it would be the final win for Don the Snake Perdomo as a car owner. Let's get to know more about the likable Texan. Spencer Massey is this week's E3 Spark Plugs Hotshot.
Hi, I'm Spencer Massey, driver of the 300-mile-per-hour Red Fuel Top Fuel Dragster. I'm born and raised in Fort Worth, Texas. I travel year-round in my bus, so I'm pretty much racetrack to racetrack. But Fort Worth, Texas is my home, and I love being there. I don't have that much free time, but when I do, I like to be at the racetrack. I either go back and help out in the alcohol dragsters, even bracket racing my little street car if I have time to, but I love racing. I got started in drag racing by doing what everybody else that comes to a drag race. You're standing at the ropes, you get to smell the nitro and you feel the power, and I'm like, wow, that's what I want to do. Awesome. Well, I love classic rock. I mean, you got to say, the music's been around for 40 years, and it's called classic rock for a reason. I love Foreigner, love Bob Seger. You got to love the Eagles, Joe Walsh, Don Henley. Don Henley's from Texas, I'm from Texas, but classic rock does not get any better than that. In 2006, I started driving Top Alcohol Dragster, won a few races, had a lot of fun, and got a big break by a guy named as Don the Snake Perdomo. 2009, got to drive an NHRA Top Fuel Dragster, and here I am right now, 2014, with Don Schumacher, driving an awesome Top Fuel Dragster.
Yeah, and that 2009 win was spectacular. His car owner, Don the Snake Perdomo, that guy, what did he say?
He said, I've never beaten the country before.
Kind of cool.
Yes, it was.
beat Larry Dixon, who, of course, was driving for the Allen Abbey team. Now it's Sean Langdon. Sean, who has an opportunity to get himself right back in this Top Fuel points race.
Definitely needs to win today, which help his chances immensely going into that final race. And like we said, we've seen this happen before. Sean Langdon, watching him all year. I mean, obviously with Alan Johnson, Brian Huesen calling the shots on that car, we've seen, you know, bits of brilliance from time to time. Yep. And every time we think, okay, he's got a handle on it, here it comes, they kind of fall off. They just haven't gotten it. They're hoping right now they do, though.
The head-to-head stats tell a story in this one. The 19th time these guys have raced, Spencer's beaten him 15 of the previous 18. And make it 16 of 19. Spencer Massey has just put another dagger in this Top Fuel Championship points race, and look how happy the Don is. You think he's happy for Spencer, or is he more happy for his son?
He's more happy for that trophy at the end of the season. That's what he's thinking about. I tell you, this was a good call because Spencer went out there and spun the tires in the middle, got a break in the first round. I saw Mike Green over there on the starting line before they fired this thing up. I gotta think he was at least overlooking that. If he gave him any input, I don't know. The car hasn't been running too bad, just except for that first round.
But J.R. Todd, when you hear your opponent right next to you, and I know it happens so quickly, what do your nerves do?
You're immediately looking for that wind light when you cross the finish line. You know, around those Allen Abbey guys, it's going to be a tough one. But Connie Coletta seems like he's up for the challenge this weekend. We got things rolling for these Optimum Battery guys, Mac Tools, a lot of big brass in the house this weekend, Vegas, and SEMA show next week, and that was cool. You know, I think 3.7s, that's good for Vegas, right?
You betcha.
Hopefully we can do it two more times.
Semifinal matchups look very, very interesting here at the Toyota Nationals in Las Vegas as J.R. Todd goes up against Billy Torrance, who has never been to a final in the Top Fuel category. He has lane choice. Same story for Spencer Massey, who had low ET of that second round, up against a racer, Leah Pritchett, that has never raced in a final round. I know we talked so much about the countdown to the championship, but how about the countdown shakeup we have had today? Well, no other night is Monday night. Monday Night Football, Andrew Luck and the Colts head to New York to take on Eli Manning and the Giants. It all happens with kickoff at 8:15 on ESPN and watch ESPN. Mike, you think they may need a little luck to win this game, the Colts? I'm speaking of.
I get it. The quarterback for the Colts. You're slick.
Got to get up a little earlier in the morning to trick Mike Dunn. Funny car ladder, looking forward to round number two. Matt Hagen races Tommy Johnson Jr. as the points leader. John Force right behind him, 41 back, takes on Tim Wilkerson. That's the countdown battle. Stat guys, we take a look at Ron Capps getting ready to race Dell Worsham.
Of course, this weekend we remember the late Raymond Beadle, the funny car champion. He passed away. You know, John Oberhofer told me that his dad Dave actually worked at Chaparral Trailers, and part of that time he painted some of the Blue Max funny cars. And Mike, they were the most beautiful race cars back in the day, where they were spectacular.
Without a doubt, it was one of the biggest cars that on the circuit back when I started in 1981, and boy, that thing booked for a lot of money on the match race circuit.
Del Worsham 0-2 racing Ron Capps this season. But now it's 1-2. Del Worsham has just knocked off Ron Capps. The yellow fellows give him a tune-up. Good for a 409 as Chip Foose is in the house. Foose has been a long time affiliated with the Coletta Motorsports organization.
Talked with John Oberhofer, Dell Worsham's crew chief, right before that run as he was making some adjustments to the car. And I asked him what he thought they had run right there. He says a high 4.0, probably a 4.09. Look at that, right on the button.
Connie keeping the dream of getting his first double alive. He's got cars in both dragster and funny car. Moving on to the semis, Dell by just that much.
With Sean Langdon, how do you digest that outcome?
It's tough. First of all, great job to the Allen Abbey team. Those are the situations that this team usually thrived off of, and it's a tough pill to swallow. You know, we really had a great car this weekend. We've been trying to turn these corners, and just kind of seems like every time we get the ball rolling, we have a little incident like that. But you know, it's not the end of the world. We still have a great team. We still have great sponsors, Redline Oil and Toyota, and everyone from Qatar with Sheikh Khaled. You know, hats off to the Army team. You know, obviously they had a great year this year. We still have a chance for second place. So it's, we're going to my home track, Pomona, California. I love that track. And, you know, hopefully we can end the year on a good note. And got to get this car back to championship form for next year, though.
Thank you, John.
And you know Alan Johnson and that team certainly will. Well, this is Robert Height, five wins, a single season high. Did that in 2011 as well as this year. But since he last won in Denver eight races ago, just one semifinal. He is taking on Paul Lee, who shocked Courtney Force in round number one. So much so that Jungle Pam, Jungle Jim, of course, is his funny car hero, Paul Lee, that is, sent a text to Lewis Bloom and says, way to go, Paul Lee.
Well, the main ingredient right there is that man, Gary Dinch, has been doing this for such a long time. And boy, he can just come out of nowhere, just sit back and make a great run like he did in the first round. So Robert Height's got to be ready.
Robert Height taking over the ride that Gary Dinchem had at John Force Racing. And he's going to be able to get the win. 4.102 as Paul Lee slowed just a little bit. 4.22, so Robert Height into the semifinals where he races the winner of John Force or Tim Wilkerson. A big moment in the countdown of the championship in Funny Car comes up next when the 16-time champ tries to keep the dream of a 17th title alive. The engines come to life for John Force, driving the American-made 16-time champ car up against Tim Wilkerson and the Levi Ray and Shop crew. It's the Toyota Nationals, the weekend stop for the NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing Series. Next weekend, the chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup continues at Phoenix International Raceway for the final race in the Eliminator Round. One of the eight nations that are battling, just simply win a race, you'll clinch a spot in the final four. Of course, it all wraps up at Miami-Dade Speedway. It's the Quicken Loans Race for Heroes 500 at Phoenix next Sunday at 2.
Before Q3, Tim Wilkerson put in a new 6-6 clutch assembly that he planned on testing next year and surprised himself with a stout 407. Now that 6-disc clutch is still in the car, but they've struggled with it the last two runs.
John Force being tuned by John Medlin for today with some assistance from Mike Knepp. And when I asked John Medlin earlier, I told you that he said it was great being back calling the shots. He said he thought he was doing a pretty good job. Well, John Force stopped him, gave him a big bear hug and said, no, you are doing a great job.
And despite that shakeup that saw Jimmy Prock leave this team, John Force is still in the peak power rankings, according to Mike Dunn.
Coming into this event, I had Matt Hagen number one. Courtney Force is already out, and John's still running for that top fuel, though. I missed on all three power rank drivers went out in the first round. I'll tell you what, that's the first time for top fuel that's happened, that all three went out in the first round.
Still love you, man, for sure.
Right back at you, Dave.
John Force, 2010, had the points lead with three races left. Gave it up in Maple Grove, got it back at Pomona. Going to try to duplicate that here. Gave it up to Matt Hagen. He'll be coming up next. Big time race right now for John Force. American-made 16-time champ driver, 4.069. That is a good one.
Man, that was a good pass. Good reaction time for John. Don't think he rolled it in very deep, maybe just a little bit, a hundredth, but still runs a 4.06. Nice job. But you see the cloud cover out there? Some tracks getting pretty tight, so they're running the big numbers.
Robert Height now knows that he's going to face John Force in the next round. How crazy has it been over the last couple of weeks with the exit of Jimmy Prock?
It has been a little crazy, but you know, seems like we always have a lot of things going on and some new things to announce, and it's never hum-ho at John Force Racing, so kind of to be expected. You know, Jimmy Prock, I've got a lot of wins, and most of those came with Jimmy Prock. He's still a good friend of mine, and we're going to miss him.
And what do you got for the boss?
We're going to have to, you know, I still have a shot with this Auto Club Ford to get this championship. And, you know, if we lose now, it's over. So it's good. We've had two first-round losses in a row, and to get to the semis here is good. But, you know, we had some unfinished business. We got to the final here in the spring, didn't get it done. I want to win today.
Thanks, Robert.
You gotta love the echo here, Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, as we have got a rematch of the final round from Maple Grove. As you take a look at points up to the moment, Matt Hagen, once the hunter, is now being hunted by John Force.
Well, I'll tell you what, he's got to be confident with that race car he has. And I think it's interesting to note the Ford Don Schumacher Racing Funny Car pretty much run a very similar combination. But boy, there's been a big difference in the way they've been running here in Las Vegas. Matt Hagen obviously been very, very stout. Tommy Johnson Jr., though, he really seems like his crew chief, John Collins, has kind of struggled here in the altitude. They didn't run well here in the spring. They're not really running that great here this weekend, but they're coming off a Maple Grove race where that thing was pretty impressive.
Remember, I was talking about 2012 Maple Grove where John Force gave up the points lead and ended up getting it back at the end of the year. He took it away from that man, Matt Hagen. That's one of those two championships that he refers to when he says John Force gave my championship speeches. So the matchup pretty simple right here. If Matt Hagen wins this round, he is guaranteed to leave the strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway with the points lead. If he loses, John Force wins this race, they'll have switched positions.
And with Matt Hagen, he has been very good on the tree all season long. Doesn't stage deep and still puts out good reaction times. Slight advantage to TJ.
But the elapsed time belongs to Matt Hagen. Even better than Force's 4.069, he goes 5 thou quicker.
4.06 for the four, low of the round.
Hagen guaranteed again to leave with the points lead.
And you heard the call. It was low as a round as you go on board with Matt Hagen. And watch this. Right, straight down.
Yeah, man. 4.064. Good job.
John Force checking on some numbers here. And as he came out of the car, you're already thinking about little points for Pomona qualifying, right?
You know, we gave it good. We ran good. I had one run where I screwed up on the clutch. I lost that first run on Saturday, and that was crucial to run that night run, and then it still ran 0-2, but something I did with my foot. So anyway, we got to make that point up. If we can get past Robert and then we get to the final, it doesn't matter who wins, he's still got a lead. We're going into that last race, and L. Robert can still win this thing. So we'll see what happens.
Thank you, John.
Semi-final matchups shake down like this as Matt Hagen and his low elapsed time of that round. Good enough for lane choice against Del Worship. He's still searching for that first funny car win in the yellow car. Then it's going to be John Force against his teammate. The last opportunity for Robert Height to stay a part of this funny car championship race. All of that is coming up. Plus the first pair in pro stock when we come back. How about Dave Conley, third in the point standings? He will race the point leader, Jason Lyon. You know who else will be interested in that pair? Eric and Ender Stevens. Come on back, see what else shakes out. Perhaps the biggest pro stock race on the NHRA Meliello Drag Racing Series is happening right now here at the Strip, Las Vegas Motor Speedway and the Toyota Nationals. It's Jason Lyon as you look across to the opposite lane and Dave Conley. Other matchups, they're great, including Erica Ender Stevens, who tries to keep pace in this championship race against Roger Brogdon.
Jason Lyon tested here at the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway last week. He said they didn't go too far out of the box, no big changes to the car. They just wanted to make sure that they had a baseline set up and that the car would be capable of running what is capable of running. Besides that, they also did a lot of dyno testing, and he says he thinks they found some things that are helping them this weekend.
In spite of that, Rob Downing told me that he's concerned about being the first pair out and as a result doesn't want to beat themselves. So he's going to set up a little conservative like they were round one. Now, Dave Conley, on the other hand, he is going after it. He said he set up soft first round and almost bit him, so he will be aggressive not only in the clutch but on the tree.
Dead even on the reaction timer. And where is Dave Conley? He has had problems. Jason Lyon wins. Perhaps when you look back on Dave Conley's season, the one Achilles heel he has had is racing Jason Lyon. That's the 10th time they've raced. 7 of those has gone to Jason Lyon.
Watch Conley. He lets a clutch out. That thing went nowhere but sideways. Wow.
Wow, big time tire shake.
Jason didn't make a perfect run either, no. But it was good enough to get the win because he at least got it to the finish line under power.
Dejection for Dave Conley and his team and the Gray Motorsports crew as they now fall another round behind Jason Lyon. It started with a 3-round deficit, and it continues to grow for Jason Lyon. Will he have a shot in Pomona? We'll have to wait till the end of the day to find out that answer. This is Jed Coughlin, who's got two wins here at Fall Vegas, 2002 over WJ, a championship season, and 2008 over Greg Stanfield, a championship season. He races Alan Johnson, his teammate.
With Jason Lyons, crew chief Rob Downing. And Rob, you know, you're getting closer to possibly winning a championship. Jason said you guys found some things thought would help in the last 3 weeks. What was it?
Well, we've been working real hard for Summit Racing, for Chevrolet, trying to do everything we can, and just taking it one round at a time. Obviously, we got a big task to do here today, but just keep plugging away.
Try to figure out how to keep those nerves in check as well.
Right now, Jed Coughlin runs very well up here in Las Vegas, and he's continued that streak here in qualifying to make a good pass. His teammate, Alan Johnson, on the other side. Also, they really, I talked with Roy on Friday. He said really what hurt them in the beginning of the countdown was they had a bad set of tires, and they just kind of kept getting put in the rotation. It was kind of throwing them off. It took them a while to figure it out. Once they figured it out in Maple Grove, they said the car runs has been running very well, but he's got his work cut out because Jeg, I think, has been running just a little bit better this weekend, but they're pretty close.
The last two Pro Stock champions are on the line right now.
Oh, look at them lights. Oh, Alan did not get down the track either.
The 004 reaction time.
6:02:14. Nice job, guys.
And at 6:62:6, Jeggy's moving on.
Well,
that was a big win for a team on a tight budget. Leah Pritchett announced this weekend that Gummit will be coming back in 2015, and now she's looking to make her first Top Fuel final round appearance of 2014. You know, she's also said that she's hoping that a good showing here this weekend will spark some interest and try and get her some funding necessary to make it in Pomona in 2 weeks.
Jason Lyon acknowledging the run by Jeg Coughlin. We heard from Rob Downing, not a fan of being the first pair out in this session.
I think you're going to have a hard time finding anybody who's a fan of being the first pair out. But, hey, man, he did a great job in our Summit coming around, made it down the racetrack, and obviously David didn't. So big deal, big round for us, and we're moving on. That's the good news.
And you got a red car maybe in your future, yeah. Driven by one Erica Andrews-Steven.
Yeah, pretty good chance of that, I'd say.
All right, we'll find out.
Now, right now, though, Gary, it's all about the defending champion here, Shane Gray, who beat V Gaines last year, coming up against his best friend, Greg Anderson.
Straight up.
Shane coming up just a bit short in the second round at straight Maple up. Grove to straight his buddy. Up. Maybe can pay him back now.
Yeah, he's got the car that can do it, and he's got lane choice, and so far we've seen some problems in that left-hand lane, at least for the Pro Stock contingent, right off of the starting line. And what the teams can do now, since Greg Anderson, they saw the couple cars spin the tires early, they can adjust the launch leave, in other words, the chip, so they'll lower that RPM, so when they let the clutch out, it doesn't hit the tire quite as hard, and hopefully it gets off the starting line. Problem is, once you do that, will it be a quick enough to get around Shane Gray, who's been making some pretty impressive runs this weekend.
Greg, four wins here at Las Vegas, second stop, but not since 2010, riding a 55 race winless streak. He's in the backyard of Ken Black, his team owner. Slight reaction time advantage to Greg. And a great finish, give it to Shane Gray. Margin of victory, just a little bit more than a hundredth of a second. That's his wife, Amber. He can breathe easy now as Ken Black tries to digest what just happened to his primary driver, Greg Anderson.
Well, I think Greg Anderson, that Summit team, did a great job because, like I said, you saw two cars not even get off of the starting line. They were a little bit slower in 60 foot, about a hundredth of a second, but still made a good run, but came up just that short at the stripe.
Well, Matt Hagen continues to flex his muscles. Let's see those guns. Come on, baby.
No guns, man. No guns.
Well, you know, the car is doing it for you. This thing has been flawless all week, and you're going to leave here as the national points leader regardless of what happens. But I know you want to go out as a winner.
Yeah, I mean, we obviously want to – hold on a second. We obviously want to win that Wally. I mean, that's what we showed up here to do. We just got to keep racing our race. Dell and those guys over there, they're going to run hard. We got to go run hard. But, you know, at the end of the day, we just got to, you know, do the best job we can, and that's what we're doing right now. So I'm excited. I feel really good about my crew and my team, and Dickie seems to be making the right calls out there. I think we were low for that round and low for the round before that, so he's running strong. He ain't playing around, so I just gotta try to drive the wheels off of it.
Now, there is no arguing that Matt Hagen has been the class of the funny car field here, especially in the countdown. Roger Brogan, you saw his bizarre round one win when Vincent Nobile turned on the red light early. He will race Erica Enders-Stevens, second in the point standings, but all season long, you can make the argument that that machine has been the class of the pro stock field.
Well, we heard Jason Lyon and Rob Downey talking about not wanting to be the first pair out. I talked with Ricky Jones early on Friday before they ran. He said that's been his Achilles heel is in eliminations, because just what they're saying, when you come up right behind the fuel cars, that track changes a little bit. That's, he likes to be farther back to where they can, the rubber kind of starts to settle down a little bit better for these cars.
The big difference
too is when you run the final round, because they reverse the order, and that really changes the way you have to set up the cars.
Erica Enders-Stevens, a big opportunity for her right now. The winner of this matchup races Jason Lyon. Dave Connolly did not have luck against the Pro Stock points leader. But wouldn't a semifinal matchup between one and two in the points, that'd be a stand-up moment there. Pay attention to what happens. To do that, though, got to get around Brockner.
That's right. He won the last race. Eject.
Get that round win. Now you have to go to the elapsed time slip to decide lane choice.
Oh, look at that.
Whammy.
Take that.
Stated another way, boom goes the dynamite.
Wow.
How about that?
Ricky and his dad didn't miss a call on that one. Wow. You know, and he was telling me too, you know, one race they were too aggressive, the other race they were not aggressive enough. And he said it was just kind of hit both sides. He said, we're gonna try not to do that, we're gonna try to hit it right in the middle. I'll tell you what, they nailed that one.
Look at Richard Freeman. He is fired up at the starting line, and why not? When you run low elapsed time of that session by more than 0.03 of a second. Well, Mike Dunn, your power ranked racers may have not fared very well in top fuel, but you've got all three of them into the semifinals. Erica with lane choice, Gray with lane choice against Jed Coughlin on the other side of the Toyota National ladder. Stat guy.
Here's the numbers on Erica and Jason this season. They've met twice head-to-head. Erica's won both, but here's the big one. Remember at the spring race, she beat him in the final round for the Wally.
Well, it has been 7 races since her win in Ohio, and in that time, just now 3 semifinals for Erica. But as we said, this has been a very kind place to her, especially in 2014. At the Spring Fling here in Las Vegas earlier this year, she doubled up, taking the $50,000 K&N Horsepower Challenge over Dave Connolly, and then came back one day later and took out Jason Lyon to double up here. Woo! Erica Enders-Stevens, she loves this town. Back at the strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway for the Toyota National. Second round action in Pro Stock Motorcycle.
Wow.
Oh boy, Michael Reyes has broke. Katie Sullivan is going to the semifinal. She raced in 2 of them last year. Guaranteed to get one here in 2014. Katie on her way back to college to become a child psychologist. Just went 7.017. The rest of the ladder here, as you take a look at the second round, we'll show you that Andrew Hines and Eddie Krawick perhaps are on a collision course. They are 1 and 2 in the Pro Stock Motorcycle points.
After 2 amazingly strong elimination round wins, Erica Enders-Stevens now ready to go against Jason Lyon. He's the points leader. We know how significant this is from our side. How significant for you, and what are you thinking?
It's huge, Gary. I mean, we looked at the ladder last night, and all 3 of us were on the same side, so we get to control our own destiny here. It's about teamwork. Teamwork makes the dream work. I've said it since the beginning of this year, and I'm so blessed to have such a strong group of guys standing behind me. Hats off to Roger. They broke their motor first round, one of our motors, and so all of our guys are over there thrashing on his car, made some big changes, and I hate that he didn't get down, but really, really proud of my team. I got to say thanks to my brother. He sends me Bible verses every Sunday morning, and this morning's really resonated with me, and I keep reading it. So here we go, 3rd round against Jason. We'll see how it turns out.
You bet.
Thank you.
A couple of Indy winners on 2 wheels, a couple champions as Matt Smith comes up against Hector Arana Sr. For Matt Smith, a little more good karma. Remember last year when his dad, Ricky Smith, earned the Pro Mod Championship on the final day of their racing season here in Las Vegas? Deja vu, it happened again. And of course, Matt went on and punctuated that with a championship of his own He goes 6.93.6 here in search of his first win this year. In fact, of the four Matt Smith Racing bikes, only his wife has won this year. That's a surprise. Well, in 2 weeks, the 2014 NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing Series comes to a close at Auto Club Raceway in Pomona, California. The 50th Auto Club NHRA Finals, the times you see on your screen. Of course, the NHRA recognizing some great moments from the last 50 years, and they invite you, the fans, to go ahead and head to NHRA.com or NHRA's Facebook page and vote on what you think. And Mike Dunn, you've worked on a top five of your own.
Yeah, we will be talking about those at the final race. And finals, there's a lot of great memories, and it was plenty hard just to pick five.
Voting on the NHRA.com or NHRA Facebook page ends Tuesday, November 11th. Vote early, vote often. Chas Kennedy, Andrew Hines, the points leader on two wheels. The only former champion racing in all four categories not to have a countdown championship. Is this his year? 008 on the reaction timer. That's Chas, though. Andrew drives around 6.94. So Andrew Hines, is he getting closer to that countdown championship to go with his three earned? Before the countdown began, the photo finish cam shows you by a bike length. Andrew hits the stripe first.
John Medlin getting John Force's car ready for the semifinals. And John, what's it like? How much pressure is on to take over a team, two races to go, that's in the championship chase?
Well, the pressure is always there, you know, but we've got a good supported group here. We've got probably the best crew in drag racing. We've got a collection of crew chiefs that all pull together. We got a common goal here. We're working real hard. That helps the pressure tremendous.
And he is doing a fantastic job, as his boss, John Forrest, told me earlier.
Eddie Krawick and Jerry Savoie now do want to send out get well wishes to Angel, who had a freak accident not racing today.
Yeah, when she had the battery box kind of roll into her and then cut into her Achilles, which is cut into her tendon, which is luckily it didn't sever. It doesn't sound like it. She may need surgery, but that was definitely a painful incident. But right now, on the line, you got Eddie Krawick and Jerry Savoie. Jerry Savoie with that resurgent Suzuki's been running very, very well, but got a tough matchup here with Eddie.
Jerry, five spoiler round wins for the non-countdown rider. Could help Andrew here in a big, big way. You know that Suzuki can stand up. And it just stood up. Jerry Savoie has taken down Eddie Krawick. I think that white alligator crew's fired up, and there is Angel working the crunches, enjoying the action here today at the strip.
Well, he's slight advantage for Eddie. Like, it's 2/10 of a second. That's almost dead even off the starting line. But how about that Suzuki? That thing has been running pretty strong since the countdown started, and it just continues, gets him into the semifinals.
Margin of victory. There you see it. The reaction back at the starting line. They are fired up, as you can well expect. Anytime you take down one of the Harleys, that's a moment for celebration. But the work not yet done for Jerry Savoie. Could he do the same thing to Andrew Hines? We will find out as those two match up. Of note, if Andrew goes on and wins this race, he will enjoy a five-round lead. Only four rounds left in Pomona. There's a lot of extra factors, the record, that kind of this and that stuff. We can't clinch that championship for Andrew Hines, but he'll certainly put a stranglehold on as you see the other pair in the semis.
Well, here they are, the teammates. They know that one of them is going to walk away in a couple of weeks with a championship trophy, but this is a big setback for Eddie Krawick. How big?
Yeah, it sure was. You know, Jerry did an awesome job. He's got a great motorcycle, a good team over there. So hats off to those guys. You know what? If I don't get it, it's a Harley 1-2 finish. That was sort of our deal coming into this race, is we wanted to solidify it and get that over with. And, you know, that's the way it's looking. So I'm excited. I'm happy. And, you know, we'll just move on to Pomona. We'll see what happens. If maybe Jerry could do it to him. Who knows? It's a tough task.
Andrew, 52 points now. How big a luxury is that? Three rounds.
Well, it's way better than if I would have lost Eddie in the next round. So I'll tell you what, you know, my heart's sitting here beating. I want this championship more than anything. I've been after this fourth one for a while now. I had three early in my career and kind of been struggling the last few years. But, you know, got two great V-Rods in our camp. Unfortunately, one of them just lost. But, hey, I'll take 20 points when I can get them.
Thanks.
What we do know, though, is it will be either Andrew Hines or Eddie Krawick. Take a look at their lead over third. Matt Smith is way back, Mike. That's incredible.
Yeah, that's pretty much unsurmountable.
You think about the Harley, seven of the last 11 years, they will win a championship with the V-Rod. I remember when the bike debuted, they first ran in the sixes. Andrew won at Gainesville. You know, the fans do love watching the Harleys race.
Great matchups coming up in the semifinals. Erica Ender-Stevens, Jason Lyon. But in Funny Car, certainly the one we're going to be paying a lot of attention to. Can Robert Height take down John Force? John looking for that 17th title, but Robert still thinks he has one more opportunity to get in the race today at the Toyota National. The NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing Series. Ain't nothing mellow about it today at the Toyota Nationals. The strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, where it is semifinal time in Top Fuel, with some interesting matchup, to say the least. A couple of racers that have never been to a final. They are Billy Torrence and Leah Pritchett up against the number one qualifier, J.R. Todd, trying to go back-to-back for a number one qualifier, grabbing a national event win. Only happened once in Top Fuel this year. And then there's Spencer Massey, the veteran of the crew, with 16 national event wins.
You saw that J.R. Todd right there going alongside Billy Torrence. Billy, the only one to qualify in the bottom half in that number 12 spot. He already did his job by taking Tony Schumacher out in the first round to help out his son, Steve Torrence. Now he's going to try to win the race.
Not going to happen. J.R. Todd is in his fourth final round of the season for Connie Coletta. Margin of victory, just under 200ths of a second. As Connie takes a big high five from Cowboy Bob Kaufman.
I love it when you see Connie smile, but J.R. Todd, 103 reaction time, not the best, but he was still better than the 106. Pretty close. Take a look at the photo finish by less than half a car length. J.R. Todd advances to the final round.
Mario Todd, that's JR's dad, celebrates J.R.'s 12th career final round that ties him in the NHRA history books with Kelly Brown. J.R. Todd can tighten this thing up just a little bit with a win. He can get it down to under 100. That's five rounds heading to the last race. Going to make it tough, but still, what a great run for J.R. Todd in the countdown to the championship. Started 10th. Geico Tractionary time. We're talking camshafts. That's what one looks like. What does it do?
It's a part of the engine that spins and mechanically opens and closes the valve. And you saw with TJ Zizzo's piece, when that thing breaks, those valves open at the wrong time and it ignites all that fuel in the manifold and does a lot of damage.
Didn't you used to grind those?
Crankshafts. Never really did camshafts.
Okay, crankshafts.
Yeah.
Pay attention.
Which is connected to the camshaft.
There you go. Now, is it going to be Leah Pritchett in the gum-out car or Spencer Massey in the red fuel top fuel dragster that will race J.R. Todd in the final?
Mike Neff awaiting this semifinal matchup. And Mike, with Jimmy Prott gone, how much more is on your plate right now?
Oh, you know, there's more, but, you know, I got John Madeline, and, you know, we always work together anyway, so, you know, a little more workload, but John Madeline, Jimmy had a great crew. And hasn't been that bad, so hopefully it goes our way here.
And of course, a big matchup coming up in Funny Car. Right now, though, Spencer Massey has the car on paper that is better than Leah Pritchett's, but Leah has also stood up in a big time way this weekend, producing career best numbers out of her dote racing entry.
And then very consistent. We talked about Spencer Massey in the first round, spinning the tires, getting that lucky break, and then coming back and making a huge run to take out Sean Langdon to help his teammate Tony Schumacher with that great 3:76.90 lap time that gives him lane choice over Leah. It's cool out there. The track seems to be pretty tight. I think he can throw a pretty good number down.
Leah tried but came up just short as Spencer Massey takes the win. 3:77.5. Pritchett right there with a game 380. It has been the year of the woman. She wanted to add her name to the resume of what's been a great year for the ladies. Just comes up short today, though, in Las Vegas against Spencer Massey.
Well, here's a guy who started the countdown of the championship in the number 10 spot. You're currently number 2, and you've still got a shot at this thing. It's a long one, but how much have you improved your hopes over the course of this day thus far?
It's been a crazy week, and I tell you, I mean, championship, to me, I mean, that's out of reach. It's a long shot, like you said. I'm just concentrating on winning this race and going to Pomona and try and win that race, Gary. That's all we can do and hope for the best. But it'd been nice maybe if I had those first two starts of the season, then see where we're at right now. But I think we got some raindrops right here. But having a lot of fun at this Coletta group. I keep saying it over and over, but I'm not lying. Connie, James, Jimmo, just everybody involved with this Optima Batteries team. It's a dream come true, man.
Of course, J.R. Todd carrying a ribbon for Lauryn Hill in the front of his car. And tonight on SportsCenter, this day's will be perhaps the only day that Lauryn Hill will play in a college basketball game as a freshman for Mount St. Joe. Her mission, though, is only beginning. It's that game is now complete. She has scored 4 points. Tune in tonight at 11 o'clock as Tom Rinaldi shares her inspiring message and a moving story of triumph in the midst of tragedy. One more game and new SportsCenter feature tonight. Be sure to check it out. In the finals of Top Fuel today, Mike, who has the lane choice?
That would go to Spencer Massey by virtue of that 3:77 elapsed time. But J.R. Todd right there with the 3:78, and I don't think lane choice really makes a difference.
Spencer Massey and his new pipe sneaking under the radar a little bit this weekend, but here you are going to the final. Man, that's got to feel good when you've got that new machine under you.
Yeah, you're exactly right. I mean, I've been wanting a new car for a long time, and so I said, hey, Don, can we finally bring this car up before we end this season? And so we did, and I'm glad we did. But it's not necessarily a car. All our race cars are exactly the same, but these guys are getting this car figured out. And I'm going to the final round. It's awesome. But more importantly, it was taking out Sean Langdon for Tony. But now we have to run J.R. Todd, and I'm pretty sure he's closing in on Tony. There's a chance for it. So you know what? This is going to be the final round for Pomona for the U.S. or for the World Championship right here in this final round. I'm going to act like this is all or nothing for Tony, for Don Schumacher Racing. This is unbelievable. I mean, I'm loving being here. I'm loving drinking Mellow Yellow. I just want to win.
All the attention at the starting line right now for a matchup between the teammates. John Force still 41 points out of first behind Matt Hagan and Robert Height. That's the first of two funny car matchups. The second one will, of course, feature the point leader. Matt Hagan, out of the number one qualifying position, has been running strong. Del Worsham, though, feels like his yellow fella led team is up to the task.
Well, right now, John Force really needs this win to keep Matt Hagan in his sights. And Robert Height has, like I said, struggled somewhat in qualifying. They didn't qualify in the top half. The boys, since elimination started, the cars looked very good. John Force, second best car on the property, no question about it. Right now, he needs to dig deep and get around Robert Height.
Robert gets away first, but John Force drives around. 4:06.9.
Stout run.
In a race that was clean, green, candles lit all the way down the 1,000-foot racetrack.
Robert Height, 0.012 of a second advantage. There was no gimmies on this one. Robert was ahead, like you said, Dave, probably to about the eighth mile. And then that Mustang of John Force started pouring the coals to 269 miles per hour to the eighth. Robert was going 262. That was the big difference. Plying the clutch through the middle of the racetrack, getting that Castle car to accelerate through the middle and drive around for the win.
The 11th final round of this season for John, the 237th of his career. His wife, Lori, Brittany, and Courtney anticipate and then celebrate John Force getting to the finals. That brings us to the championship point leader, Matt Hagan and Del Worsham. Remember a year ago when the driver of the Express Lane car won 5 times. Nobody won more in funny car, but it's been a little bit of a different path this year. He's got 3 wins. He could get to that 5 again, but he would get there at the right time of the year.
Yeah, it's all about peaking at the right time, and that car's been running very, very good. Obviously, the number one qualifier, the only 3-second pass here at Las Vegas at 3:98 in qualifying. Since then, though, a 4:07 and a 4:06 in the first two rounds. How about John Force, though? He went 4:06.9 this round. He went 4:06.9 in the second round and a 4:08 in the first round. Right now, Matt Hagan, boy, he's got his work cut out, strictly focused on trying to get around Del Worsham. It's going to be not going to be easy. Track conditions are there. If Dickie Venable can pour the coals through it and hooks, hang on.
Dickie Venable says no major adjustments, just a few little tweaks for the conditions that they are faced with right now. He says he's looking to run a 4:05.
Well, Del Worsham does have a win here, but it was Top Fuel in 2011, a huge win that helped him earn the title that year. Can he have something to say about the funny car race this year? With a 4:05.9, just opened the door back up for the 16-time champ. How do you say thank you, John?
Holy.
Oh, man.
We're stunned.
Matt Hagee does a job, gets the advantage off of the starting line. I thought it would probably be all over as long as we didn't see a tire smoke, and the conditions are way too good for these cars to smoke the tires unless you just have a mechanical issue. Matt Hagee, though, just came up short. Got to possibly just drove through the clutch a little too much. Del Worsham, 270 miles per hour of the eighth. He runs the 405 and makes it to the final.
Reaction from Jim Oberhoffer, John Oberhoffer's brother. Connie Coletta has an opportunity to double today. The sixth time he's had that opportunity, it's something he has yet to do as Hagen sits in quiet disbelief.
John Force, how much do you enjoy this type of drama? How much do you thrive on it?
I loved it my whole life. I just wish I could get that point back from last night. But I got a round here to win, and you're up against Dale Worsham. Nobody knows the funny car better than him. And then he's got that Coletta. Old man Coletta's probably out there tuning this thing with his voice. He's something else. But you know what? I just want to say, my heart's really good. It's really relieved. Not over a round. Hell, he's still a mile ahead of me. But I got people across America, around the world calling me. I got a guy from Mississippi. Don't have a clue who he is. Talk to him every day. And all he talks about is you will not fail. The world will not allow you to fail. And that is, and failing doesn't mean winning a championship. Failing means when you lose heart, you failed. And that is not John Ford's. And like that car says, well, that one says Express Lane. My car says American made. That's who I am. That's where I come from. That's how I'll die. And that's what I love about her. My whole career has been on Goodyears. Never forget that. And they're American made.
And when John Ford says he wants that point back from last night, what does he mean?
He's talking about the problem with the clutch, and I gotta believe possibly got a little bit too much heat in the clutch, probably in the third session, because he did not get any points in that session. Had he got that one or two little points there, he would have had that round back.
Del Worsham just threw down against the points leader, and with that 405.9 pass, he will pick his lane in the Toyota Nationals Funny Car Final against the 16-time champion, John Forrest. Back in a moment.
On a spectacular Sunday afternoon in the high desert just north of Las Vegas, we're at the Strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, and the drama continues to ratchet up in terms of the countdown to the championship. We're with Matt Hagen at the top end of the racetrack. I guess it would only be fitting that you and Force duke it out at Pomona.
Yeah, you know, Lady Luck wasn't on our side today. Good on him if he can go out there and win that thing, but, you know, it's going to come down to Pomona no matter what, so... let's go have some fun doing that. We'll enjoy this little points lead that we do have still, and we'll just work hard and figure out what happened there and come back strong.
Thanks. Thank you. Guaranteed to leave with that point lead. If John wins, it'll be a single marker heading to Pomona. Shane Gray, one of four cars in the Pro Stock semifinals. He will race Jed Coughlin. Then it's going to be Erica Ender-Stevens in a Titanic matchup against the Pro Stock point leader, Jason Lyne.
Gets the advantage off of the starting line. I don't think Shane's going to be able to chase him down. He is not. Shane makes a bad run. Jed Coughlin runs a 660 at 208 miles per hour to advance to the final once again in Las Vegas.
Shane Gray, the defending champion, was looking to go back-to-back here at this race in Las Vegas. Too much Jed, too much timely, quick-shifted by the Jegs.com driver. And the reaction from the starting line, as you'd expect it to be, from Amber Gray. Disappointed that her hubby did not get the opportunity to go to the final today. Doggone it.
Let's check in here with Del Worsham. Boy, the smile speaks volumes. We were talking to Spencer Massey a little bit about flying under the radar. I think you and your yellow fella guys have been doing kind of the same thing. How good's that race car?
That round there, it was just excellent. You know, just kind of picking away at it. Yesterday was a tough day, you know, for the DHL Toyota Camry. But today, thing came around, and for the 2015... Toyota Camry, you know, it's out there. We have the new body out this weekend to make a debut with the Toyota Nationals with it. It's awesome. We're in the final round, and I saw Cameron from Redline Oil and the Mac Tools and all of our sponsors here right now. Cowboy Bob, it's a great place to try and get a win.
Thanks.
All right, guys. Thank you.
And now the Pro Stock Championship takes center stage. Del Worsham just upset the number one man in points. The number one man in points in Pro Stock is that man, Jason Lyne. But there's a woman in the lane opposite. It can really make this an intense battle heading to Pomona. Stat guy.
Let's talk about driving here in 2014. Erica, 7 hole shot losses, 1 hole shot win. Jason Lyne, 5 hole shot losses, 3 hole shot wins. I do believe it could come down to the Christmas tree.
I got to believe you're right, Lewis, because this is the big time battle, number one and two in the points. And like I said, Erica's been doing a good job. the problem they've been having is making four good runs on race day. Jason Lyon, we've documented the fact that he had a dominating race car over the summertime, has fallen off a little bit, still has a good race car. But I think he's going to want to just push the tree as much as he can to try to take out Eric Anders.
The biggest round of racing for Eric Anders Stevens' career?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, this is important. It may come down to even bigger one in Pomona, but right now, it's you got to be really focused, got to be on it. But she's confident. If they've got the car underneath her, I think she feels pretty good.
Don't forget, she doubled back here in the spring. Loves this racetrack. Of a second.
Didn't matter.
Wouldn't have mattered anyway. Yeah. Erica with the
look
hammer.
At that run.
6:59.3. All of her passes today by that Richard Freeman Elite Performance Team have been in the 6:50 range. Erica Ender Stevens gets closer to the Pro Stock lead and history for the women.
Well, Jason Lyon had to push and he just missed 003. The car just moved. He was ready for it just a little too quick. Like he said, we said, it wasn't going to matter. Go on board with Erica. She was 009 reaction time, a 6:59.3 elapsed time. That was going to be next impossible to beat even if you hit the setup.
Take a look at the reaction from inside the car. Greg watching. Sees the red light come on. Head to the chest. Knows now all they can do is sit and watch and wait to see what will be at stake when we get to Pomona. What we do know about the Pro Stock Final is that Erica Anders will have lane choice against Jeggy. Who will have lane choice in the Pro Stock Motorcycle Semifinals? Andrew Hines on the top side. And then on the bottom side, it will be Matt Smith. Andrew, oh, Jerry Savoie, 004 for Andrew. What Jerry did to Eddie Krawick, he could not do to the man who extends his lead in the points. Andrew Hines gets the win.
Well, I tell you what, Andrew Hines did it in convincing fashion. Watching Eddie Krawick, he was leaving too. He knew that was a good launch. A hundredth of a second over Jerry Savoie, looks at the big screen, says, yeah, that's my boy.
Got to be a bittersweet moment, though, because that means his road to the championship just got to be 20 points harder. He now finds himself 72 back. Andrew goes on and wins this race. That number will grow even larger.
We'll check in here with Erica Anders Stevens. You've been laying down good, strong laps one after another all day. Now the door has opened in terms of the championship. What are you going to have to say to yourself to keep the nerves straight and the focus right?
I guess get it, girl. I mean, we've positioned ourselves awesome. Hats off to my team. Teamwork makes the dream work over and over and over again. But just staying focused. You know, my crew chief came on the radio and said, if we want it, we got to go get it. And that's what we did. And I couldn't be more proud of the entire group. I mean, I keep preaching the team, but they're so awesome. And so many people make this possible. United Mechanical, Mark Stockseth, Engines Inc., the guys back in Arkansas, we appreciate all y'all do for us. And man, we're going to the finals in Vegas again. We did this in the spring, and I'm hoping the results are the same. We'll do our best and let God do the rest. Thanks.
Just a moment ago, you saw Katie Sullivan sit up in the saddle. Matt Smith gets the win. He's the defending champion of this event. He will go into the final against Andrew Hines. John Force faces Del Worsham in the Funny Car Final. What's at stake? John Force able to climb within a point disadvantage of Matt Hagan. Are we looking at the first female Pro Stock champion? She's got a great shot too, Mike.
We're in Vegas. I wouldn't bet against it.
You love finals. We love finals. And they're next from Las Vegas.
The NHRA Toyota Nationals is brought to you by Mellow Yellow. Go on yellow. And Toyota. Let's go places. And GEICO. Saving people money on more than just car insurance.
The bright lights, the big city, and some of the beautiful casinos here in Las Vegas, Nevada. The place, the Toyota Nationals, where Jason Lyon now holds on to a scant 3-point lead after being knocked out in the semifinals today.
Well, Jason, going into that semifinal against Eric Anders Stevens, you knew you had to just about be perfect, missed it by about 3 thou. Is that what was going on, just pushing too hard?
Yeah, I was trying to be perfect. You know, we had to. Our Summit Chevy Camaro just, we couldn't get her to perform very good today. So, and you know, you'll have days like that. So, when you have those days, you got to try to be a little faster on the tree, and it bit me. But it wouldn't have mattered anyway. They're running great right now. It's not over yet, though.
That's right. There's one more race to go for Jason.
But for the lucky eight that represent the four professional categories, there is the final also here today at the Toyota Nationals. Because the Pro Stock Motorcycle finale features two champions, two Indy winners, but amazingly, Andrew Hines and Matt Smith have not raced in a final round since 2008. Stat guy.
Andrew Hines, the last time he qualified number one was the finals in 2012. But the last five times he's been the number one qualifier prior to that, he has won the event.
Your number one qualifier, Andrew Hines, against your number two qualifier, Matt Smith. Just the way you draw it up.
Defending champion, that is Matt Smith. His dad, Ricky, for the second consecutive year, clinched the Pro Mod Championship earlier today. It's karma on the side of Matt Smith. Small hole shot advantage. And it's going to be Andrew Hines by 88 ten-thousandths of a second. That's the margin of victory. And the point lead has grown almost insurmountably for Eddie Krawick.
Good race. Good job, boys. Good job, Eddie.
Just a great drag race in the final by the two best motorcycles on the premises. You take a look at Andrew Hines just driving around and getting the win by about a wheel length.
Sixth win of his season, 38th of his career.
Congratulations, Matt Hines. Another dominating performance for the Vance and Hines Harley-Davidson team.
It was great. We had a little bit of trouble there with Eddie in the second round, and Andrew saw an opportunity, and he's been going rounds, and that was a close one. So it's hats off to Andrew and the whole Harley-Davidson team for getting it done this weekend.
With Andrew Hines, you were talking a bit earlier about how badly you want a championship. It's been since 2006. You haven't won in the countdown. How good does this feel now? Because it looks like you've taken a giant step toward that accomplishment.
This is a big deal. You know, it sucks that he went out early. Hats off to my teammate. You know, he's the one that makes me better. He pushes me to strive to be as best as I can be. I don't know how I was there in the final on the tree, but to get four wind lights, you know, that's what I came here to do. Vegas has been good to me in the past. It's been bad to me a couple years ago, but my dad, he helped me make some calls when we were back at the shop those last few weeks, and he kept my head straight for this last race. Thank you, Dad. That's awesome. Tanya Declan, love you. Daddy's bringing home another Wally Declan. It's pretty awesome.
See you in Pomona.
Thank you.
The fourth win in Las Vegas for Andrew Hines, who has a five-round lead. Mike, in essence, he shows up at Pomona, qualifies. Nothing anybody can do.
I'm betting he does it.
Not the best color man in the business for nothing. Pro stock time now. Saw Chet Coughlin go streaking by. That is Erica Ender-Stevens. She is the only pro stock number one qualifier to win from that position this season. This is the first time she's racing JEG in a final round.
Earlier I talked with Ricky Jones on Friday about these certain conditions on race day, and he said it's constantly changing for the pro stock cars. Heard about this in the past, because remember, the order is reversed. They run ahead of the fuel cars. That is a different starting line than what they're used to, but he's feel confident that he's been able to make the adjustments based on what he did in St. Louis and Maple Grove. Take a look at her road to the final. A dominating performance. That car has been just running outstanding with that car in the other lane, but Jet Coffin's been running very, very good this weekend also.
We continue to say 2014 has been the year of the woman on the NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing Series. They have amassed big-time wins courtesy of four racers, and now Erica Ender-Stevens is in position to take the points lead. That is one thing the NHRA has never had, a female pro stock champion.
I spoke to Erica's husband, Richie Stevens, before this round and asked him how she's been holding up under the pressure. And he told me that she is rock solid right now, and in large part to the support she's gotten from the Elite Motorsports team. Win, lose, or draw, they have been life-changing, the support she's received.
Jet Coughlin again in the left-hand lane. He was there in the semifinals, and they were very conservative, but the data has shown that they can be a little more aggressive. So they say they're really going to go for it right now.
For Erica Ender-Stevens.
Say goodnight.
Numbers that give her her 11th career race win and probably the biggest one ever, because it gives her the pro stock points lead right back.
What a race for the final round. Oh man, was she ready? She needed to be, because like we said, Jeg's been running very well all weekend. He lays down a nice pass, 659.6, but That was nothing compared to that 007 light and a 658 set with a 7 in the final round. You go on board with Erica, watch it go through the gears, watch it pull away from Jeg for the win. Nice job.
If Erica goes on and takes this championship, she will look back very fondly on the strip at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. She has swept the Vegas races this year, and you can already hear inside the helm, car under the helmet still. This is going to be one very happy lady when she steps out.
Western Swing, Richard Freeman, how excited are you to finally get back that points lead?
Well, it's amazing. It's a testament to my guys, Nick and Jake, all the guys back at the shop. Ricky and Ricky Jones, it's our whole group. Erica's fantastic. It's surreal right now, and we're very, very blessed. Happy to be here.
And as Erica comes out, the Wally is there, the winner's hat is there, a 007 light. Considering what's on the line on this day, have you ever been better?
I guess not, but you know, it's because of the guys that stand behind me. I give the good Lord all the glory. I prayed this morning and just said I give it to him and I trust him, and we're gonna go out there and execute the best that we possibly can. And you know, I'd be lying if I said I wasn't nervous going up there. I mean, Jeggy's the best that there's ever been in this class, and I've got all the respect for him in the world, but it was dark up there. I was 009 last time. I'm like, man, I don't want to go red. I don't want to go red. My crew chief said, if you want it, you got to take it. So, Jeggy, thank you.
Oh, nothing feels better than a mellow yellow bath. Well, that is Del Worsham. He will take on the American-made 16-time champ, John Force, who can climb to within a point of Matt Hagen. Talk about delivering on a day the New York Times put out an online article about success of women in the NHRA. She delivers, takes over the Pro Stock points lead, takes it away from Jason Lye.
Boy, just a great job by Erica and the entire team. She hugs Richard Freeman. Good job.
Well, for Del Worsham, this is his fourth attempt to win a race in the Scott Coletta Funny Car. To do that, he has got to beat John Force.
Talking with his crew chief, John Oberhofer, he says that they aren't leaving any cards on the table. They are giving it some more power, a little bit more clutch. Very important to get Della win in this car, but it's even more important because it was Scott's car, and their last win came in Chicago almost 2.5 years ago.
Back in the pits, John Force told me he is now more focused than ever, and that for the first time all season, he can breathe a sigh of relief and focus on the task at hand, and that is doing what he loves, driving his funny car.
A couple of veterans, their first ever final came way back in the day, 22 years ago, Atlanta. Win, and look at the slug from brother Jimbo. Jono just took one to the gut.
Oh, man. Well, it's about time Del Worsham got a win in that DHL funny car.
Amen.
What a great win it was. You saw John Force go deep stage that thing. He put the top light out. Helped his reaction time, but he was basically robbing it. Take a look at the margin of victory at the top end. Del Worsham wins by a nose in a great final.
The 26th career funny car race win ensures Matt Hagen carries more than a one-round advantage into the final. Bruno.
Well, John, how you feeling after that punch to the gut? It's got to feel a whole lot better when you look at the scoreboard. You guys flying under the radar. What did you find during eliminations?
We just got our head out of our butt. That's about it. You know, we have a good team. We have a lot of valuable input from a lot of people. You know, this one's for Raymond Beadle. I had my Blue Max pin on all weekend. And, you know, I grew up down in Dallas. My dad used to take us over to the shop all the time. So this is hats off to Raymond Beadle. He was one of my idols, you know, and I just want to say we love you to the family. And this is for Scott as well. They got two champions upstairs, so it's really important to us.
All the safety gear comes off. The first win in 5 years in a funny car for Del Worsham. Maybe more importantly and more significantly, the first one in a car that is still known as Scott Coletta's car. How satisfying is this moment, Del?
Goodness, man. It's been a tough road coming back driving funny cars. Won this race in 2011 with Alan Johnson, the Alan Abbey guys, and then, you know, it's just been a long time and some hard knocks, but this entire team is DHL. Toyota team, the new Camry this weekend just performed outstandingly, you know, and kept it together. We kept trying. We stuck together. It's a great group of guys back there, and rooting on J.R. Todd and his Optima car, Doug Coletta, Alexis, great teammates, and my goodness, I just want to kiss everybody right now.
I'm
getting out of here.
Well, Del Worsham just won Funny Car for the first time. He won at Top Fuel. You heard him mention that earlier, and now he's going to see if his teammate, J.R. Todd, can win in Vegas in a Top Fuel car for the first time. If he's able to knock out Spencer Massey here, you'd think the first mosh pit was good. Hold on.
It'll be something as you take a look at J.R. Todd's road to the final. A little bit different than Del Worsham from the standpoint. Del qualified on the bottom side of the ladder, won from the number 12 spot. J.R. Todd, your number one qualifier. Spencer Massey, your number two. Like we said, that's the way you draw it up on paper, but it usually doesn't happen that way, especially in the fuel category.
It's that guy. Take you back to the spring race. Alexis DeJoria driving for Connie Coletta, won Funny Car, but Tony Schumacher driving for the Don stopped Doug Coletta for the double for the legend, Conrad Coletta.
J.R. Todd told me that he is feeling good about the cooler track and atmospheric conditions, and he feels it favors Connie Coletta's tune-up. He said it's going to take a mid-70 or better to get it done in the final, and watch out, because if Connie Coletta and that team doubles up, it is going to get ugly down here on the starting line.
More history on Spencer Massey's new car. They decided Saturday at Reading to bring it out. It was still on the jig. They started putting it together during the three-week break, and they finally got it finished early last week and put on the truck to come out here, and they're glad they did it.
The eighth attempt for Connie Coletta to double, the sixth time this season. It's never happened for the legend, and it's not going to happen again today. Give it to Spencer Massey, who earned it with a great 375.6. A lapse time, even better with the speed. That's a track record, 330.88 mile per hour pass.
Wow, that's making a statement there. Spencer Massey, he was ready for a great reaction time. Looked like J.R. Todd couldn't really tell what happened. Don't know if he shook the tire. Track conditions are pretty tight out there. Boy, for Spencer Massey, they're loving that brand new race car.
I'm here with Phil Schuler. Phil, how much has it meant having Todd Okahara back with you, co-crew chiefing this car?
It means a lot. Me and Todd work really well together, and having him a little more to help me out means a lot to me. I couldn't do it without him ever. We put a whole brand new car together coming here from our shop in Brownsburg, and just hats off to them guys. They built a nice piece. We came out of here, hit the ground running with it, ran good all day.
Spencer Massey, I know you said you lobbied the Don to get this new car together, but did you have any clue that it might be this good right out of the box?
Well, what do you say? Whenever these Don Schumacher guys at the shop build these race cars, they build them perfect. Now, I've been running that same car for the past year and a half. There's nothing wrong with our old car. I just like to have a new car. His new pipe's always good, but this red fuel car is awesome this weekend. I mean, all four runs and eliminations except for first round when we're going to have to do a bunch of pedal fest. It was awesome. 70s, I mean, we had the Odyssey battery guys with us. We took out the Optima battery car in the finals just now. I mean, that's amazing. And to have the red fuel guys here, and we're promoting this product really awesome. It's a phone charger that you can get at Walmart here pretty quick. You can get at the racetrack every national event you come to. We sell them at our t-shirt trailer, and they'll be in every Napa Auto Parts store. This is amazing. I've always won four races in a year. I've only won two until now. Now I'm three. We have one race left, one race to make it four. This is amazing. Thank you, Meliello. Thank you, Schumacher. Thank you, everybody back in Texas. This is awesome, guys.
John Force didn't get the win today, but he did close the gap 21 points behind Matt Hagan as we head to the finale in Pomona. And John, are there such things as moral victories, and is this one of those?
Well, you hit it dead on. You know, bottom line, when my guys were going away, I told them, everybody stay calm. We won, and all them kids looked at me because where we came from, I don't look like I'm thinking it, but I was thinking maybe we were in trouble. And I really learned my lesson about believing in my guys, how they could come back and rally. I've got to give credit to John Medlin being right in the heat of that battle. I got to give Mike Neff, jumped over, you know, took over at the reins, and they worked together running Robert Heights Auto Club car. I mean, helping the guys with Courtney's and Brittany's cars. So it's a, you got to win on the racetrack, and we didn't, but we won the morale battle, and this thing is mental when you play it against other teams. And right now they know John Force Racing is back. As a team, we never missed a lick. We were off a point, one lousy point. Oh.
The funny car points battle, that goes on to Pomona, as does Schumacher's quest for his eighth, and Erica in position for a Pro Stock Championship. It all wraps up, Mike Dunn, at the Golden Anniversary of the Auto Club Finals.
The 50th anniversary of the finals. We've seen some great finishes, and I have a feeling this one's going to be just another one.
Yeah. On behalf of our entire ESPN2 crew, thanks for joining us. We'll see you in 2 weeks when we wrap up the 2014 NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing season.